I'm Andrew Raycroft. You're listening to Missin Curfew.
Obes, friends at Good Life, again, what keeping us clean, keeping us fresh, keeping us looking good.
You've built with these guys for us here at Missin Curfew. They had us in their store, National League store.
I'm just going to throw this out there. They are our best, clothing sponsor.
They got some.
They make us fresh.
It's all I wear now. It's all I wear. I have to count, but I think I got black. I think I got 10 black Good Life tees in my closet. A couple V's, couple, what's this called? A crew neck up, dog?
That's crew.
Crew. Uppy, I need some more sweatshirts. I'm going to put an order in here with our new promo code, which is
Curfew at www.goodlifeclothing.com.
The sweatshirts are unbelievable. I've lost a couple in the shuffle. That's I'm going to wait till I move into my new place before I make this order. And then I'm ordering sweatshirts. And for you guys out there, New Year's resolution, you're laying off the sauce, you're hanging in, being a good boyfriend or a husband, watching sports, trying to be
boring,
on a diet.
Boring.
Get the sweatpants shorts to watch games in. They're unbelievable, super comfortable.
Rub your nuts.
I would recommend going commando with them while you watch the game. Check it out. Good Life Up Dog promo code.
Curfew.
Welcome back to a fresh new episode of Missing Curfew. I'm Shane O'Brien.
And I'm Scotty Upshaw.
Hey, Up Dog.
What's up?
Fuck, not much, buddy. What a weekend.
Good weekend, huh?
Depends how you look at it.
We're all on the West Coast, so that's good.
I took a fucking beating this weekend,
bro. Did you?
All my hard work. What is it, in rounders? Down the fucking drain.
Any coconut oil on the beating or just sandpaper?
Just straight lube. All my fucking hard work for 2 months on my first period overs, me and my boy Tom Riley on DraftKings, all that hard work gone in the matter of 4 fucking football games and 2 UFC fights. See you later. Gone.
The UFC will get you. I know nothing about UFC. It's a coin toss, but I did all right. I managed to, I caught the heavyweight match. And talk about heavyweight.
Those are some big boys.
Where were your seats?
They were looking a little tired in there. And I was like, oh, these guys are moving like me when I was playing in Finland. Our seats were unbelievable. Shout out to Evan Knapp. Got us 6 seats.
Could you imagine trying to get off of
with that Nagano laying on you?
Can you imagine that?
And he's got a tore MCL and ACL. He's still in there and fought that guy.
Wow, I didn't know that when I bet him.
Yeah, the big boy.
Yeah.
I was going to take him too, and then I listened, of all people, we bring it talking about every week, Larry Flowers. Flowers says, you got to take the guy from Paris. He's more complete. He looked like a fucking pussy Frenchie.
He looked like Flowers. Fucking chunky.
I mean, the fight, though, that was the fight of the night, was Figueroa and Moreno. The two
Did you like that?
They were going toe-to-toe.
Okay, so on TV, it didn't look like... It looked like they could have gave it a little extra.
Oh, yeah?
And now I just go back to that Chandler fight. That we saw in New York.
Yeah.
And those guys were going at it. Like, is it just because at the Honda Center, they don't want to fucking hit each other hard?
That was the greatest fight you've ever seen in maybe UFC history.
So
it was at Madison Square Garden, and it was just like...
I'm screwed now.
But at the Honda Center, obviously, Moreno being Mexican, there was tons of Mexican fans in there. There was a buzz in the building. There was piss all over the floors in the bathroom. I go in for the first couple fights, and I'm like, look at this fucking bathroom. This looks like Bonnaroo day 3. There's piss everywhere.
Where are all the babes at?
Yeah, and then sure enough, I'm running before the one fight, and the two people are like, bathroom's closed. I'm like, come on. Yeah, I peeked around the corner. I'm like, yeah, okay, bathroom's
closed. Did you just go down into Getsy's and Getsy's stall?
I just kept running down the fuck until the next one was open. But it was a great atmosphere. Everyone was cheering for him, but I don't know. I think in the third round when Figueroa dropped him, I think that was the difference. But I took him. He's a huge favorite. He got smoked. And then I took Gone.
So seats were mint, way better than what we had in MSG?
Not quite as close to the ring in MSG, but
up, good eye level.
Yeah, like above where it was, and you could see
it. Felt like we had the camera in our way there.
Yeah, sometimes if you're down low.
But it's still, you could hear it.
Yeah.
The fucking sounds of these guys hitting each other in the face. Those
fucking Nelk boys, they were rolling 40 dudes deep in the fucking all the seats. So I reached out to DraftKings and Jill Limpson, who knows a person at UFC, and I was like, I need 4, down where the fucking,
down with the Nelk.
And I thought I had him, and then fucking week before the fights, they're like, ah, sorry, there's no more tickets left. And then I'm like, well, maybe the Nelk boys don't need fucking 70.
That's what happens when you make NFTs and you make 250 million.
Well, they bring in all dudes. Where's all the hot chicks for their videos?
These guys don't know how to fuck, do they?
I think the two of them do, yeah. I think, what's their name, Bigger? Steve or something?
Steve will do.
And the other guy, Canadian guy, sat beside him first class from L.A., Toronto, LA.
They're doing some thumping, aren't they?
I think the two head guys are, yeah. And then they're great. They bring their buddies around and try to get them laid. They'll bring these virgin guys on trips to like Miami and Cancun.
They're like the flowers.
They're like, let's see if these guys can get laid. So I'm just joking. I love the Nelk boys. I just thought
they're killing it.
I just thought we could have got a couple tickets down there.
Did they not? You should have fucking went up and said what's up.
I couldn't get down there.
Oh, so they're in between
the
ropes.
Hey, you know,
I'm sure they'd shoot the shit with you,
Johnny Knoxville.
Oh, I did see all that. They showed all those guys.
Yeah, because there's a new Jackass Forever coming out.
That's insane.
And the one scene is like, they tell their buddy that, hey, he's just got to wear a jock strap. But hey, don't worry, it's only like the lightweight champion. And then the fucking Francis Ngannou comes around, the heavyweight champ. The guy's like, what? And he just punches him either in the balls or in the stomach.
These poor guys are still going. I guess when you need to make a buck, why not make another movie and get kicked in the nuts? But
yeah,
could you imagine?
No.
All the Jackass films and all the fucking, you know, the snakes that have bit their fucking shafts and all that. It's disgusting. It's crazy.
One of the grossest ones ever was when fucking...
anytime there's shit involved, it's
gross.
When
they fucking trimmed the guy's pubes and then put the pubes on the guy's beard and made him look like he was one of those, like, you know, like terrorists or something. Remember that one scene? And like pubes in the guy's mouth and shit? I'm like, oh, I don't know how much money that's worth. Imagine getting Larry Flowers pubes fucking glued to your lip. Right? That's what it would be like.
I'm going to puke.
Okay, real quick here. We're getting off track. Sorry, I haven't seen you a couple of days. Seattle, baby.
How was it?
Yeah. Cold up there or what?
I got to go watch some hockey. Is it cold in Seattle? Let me answer that.
It's like Van, right? Like cold.
When I woke up, I looked online or, you know, check out the weather app. Mm-hmm. And you don't do that in California ever, do you? I never do that here.
I just open my blinds.
Yeah. Totally.
Fucking. Open my blinds to see if there's any fucking
come
clouds
out of bed, okay, buck diddy, just ready to rock, a day. So anyway, what's like, you know, in degrees Celsius, say, you know, 8 degrees Celsius, feels like -8 there because it's so moist. It's like the clouds, like Van, right? The clouds are low and it's just a lot of moisture like in the air and it's fucking cold. And I'll tell you when it's cold. It's 7:30 a.m. when you show up to the driving range.
You played golf at 7:30?
I played three rounds of golf in 3 days. And I got a shout out to my boy. So I went up there with Big Guy. Our boy, little work trip.
Right?
Our boy PJ. We went up there. I went up there to watch some hockey. I caught a Blues game and I left before the Panthers game, but two of my old squads. Yeah. And it was great. I got to see all of them.
How's the Fact Daddy doing?
The Fact Daddy's great. I had dinner with the Fact Daddy and then they went and just pumpernickled the Seattle.
Did he have a Jameson?
He had a.
We
had an old fashioned. And then I saw, you know, Bertuzzo. I saw Bob was the man. Tori Krug. I met Krug. I met Falk. Krug's a beauty. Thick little fucker. Good player. I've been now isocamming him a lot more now that I met him, and he's played good. They got, you know, shellacks last night, he's their best D. Falk's great. Pareko's been playing good. But I got to catch up with those boys, and it was great. So I did want us to shout out my boy Schwartzy. He got hurt in Seattle. He had surgery on his wrist.
Okay.
You know what he did? He actually, fucking poor guy. He popped a ligament off his finger, and they had to go in and fix it because that fucking ligament gets lost up in your arm if you don't. So, my best thoughts to him. He's good though. He back in good spirits. Seen all his boys from the Blues, you know, in town. He took them all to his golf club. This Eldara Golf Club, beautiful track.
They keep the courses open all year round there?
Fuck, all year round, but in great shape too. This is a Fazio club. Obviously, Fazio does a lot of discovery properties.
Yeah. I'm surprised the courses are open all year round.
This membership is great. So shout out to my boy.
Guy's a member at Big Canyon in California, and he's like, this Seattle's great.
I'm telling you. Yeah? I'm taking you up there too. These beauties.
I'll go in July.
So Ian Ritchie, good guy from Winnipeg, beauty.
Okay.
And his boy Ross Truesdale, beauty. They took, so basically, you know, they all hosted us and the Blues the day before their game. We all go out there and we played like 7 holes. It was freezing. Next day is supposed to be nice, Friday. So they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, well, me and Big Guy are in town. So we go out and we meet them. So This Ian, this guy, fuck, is he a beauty. Plays hockey. Good dude. Two little kids, play lacrosse, made the national team. So shout out to his kids. We show up in the town car to grab him at his house, and he's got mimosas fucking on ice ready to go with the bottle of Vouv and OJ. So this is how this guy runs. Good guy. So we get to the club. Then it's Caesars, not fucking Bloody Marys. Classy Canadian fucking Caesars, right? And then we get out there, and on the turn, shout out to our boys at Crown Royal and our ladies at Crown Royal.
Yeah.
The Manitoba Martini Zobes. That's the Crown and Cokes of fucking.
Is that what they're called?
Of Manitoba.
That's unbelievable.
Right? So that. Crown and Cokes on the turn. Fuck, where we were feeling good. So awesome time. Thanks to those boys. The Seattle Kraken, what a fucking rink they built.
Yeah?
It's beautiful.
Is it nice?
Yeah. So a lot like SoFi Stadium, where it's basically ground level. You walk in and you're already like up top, and you just. You sink like, you know, four stories. You know, MSG is built 10 stories up. These puppies are built down low.
Yeah.
So beautiful place. Great rink. You know what? They don't have a fucking Jumbotron in the center of the ice.
They have two of them, don't they?
They got two on the fucking.
What's that like?
On the top, basically top circles in each zone. Wow, that's really funky.
Was it funky?
Beautiful for a fan. Tough for the head coach. Tough for a player. Like still, you know, check out what's going on in the Jumbotron.
Yeah, like,
I didn't mind that.
Did I turn that one over? Was that me?
Who's yeah,
that?
Was yeah,
that?
Yeah. That's what Let I was Let me see like, that replay. Did you see that toe drag?
Now they just have to look down there, right? We never had those. Did you have those when you played? I never had the TV. Did you have that?
The TVs usually were behind the coaches on the ground. So like on the coaches.
Yeah, I was out of the league before that. So you had that near the end of your career.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'd always have to look up.
Yeah. Well, I didn't mind looking up, eh? But no, it was a great weekend all in all. You know, and then I see some Panthers guys. I saw Hubie and Ekblad, your boy Weegs.
What's Weegs?
Weegs a beauty. Yeah, he misses you.
Yeah, yeah. I love that kid, man.
Yeah.
I love
so, that kid. You know, Hubie's going to be at the All-Star game and well-deserved. He went out the next night in Seattle, got 3 points, like his eyes closed.
He's fucking 1 point behind. He's leading the whole league in scoring. Yeah.
He's arguably right now. He is arguably the best player in the league right now on the best team.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, Hart Trophy winners, you got to be on a good team. You can't just be fucking leading your team down the toilet bowl.
The old toilet bowl. Yeah, no, he was 1 point back right here. Yeah, he's tied with Drysdale, 58. Ovechkin, 58. McDavid, 55. I still think McDavid's going to win it. But yeah. Were you guys in a golf cart with like...
Doors. They got the fucking doors on the golf cart. I got to like, send Princey a pic.
I would say that's when you probably just say, boys, we're not playing today, right?
No, and heaters in the cup cart. They get the gas heaters coming. And I'm telling you, it was fucking
you
cold.
You got to love the game, my man.
I love the game.
You got to love the game to get out there. So.
And hey, shout out
to
Casey and our boys at TaylorMade.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, we did the unwrapping the other day and it was beautiful. And thank you. Look at these fucking drivers. Look
They're
at this
mint.
Thing. Look at this thing right here.
Yeah.
The new Stealth Bomb, carbon wood.
I shot 78 with it on Friday.
So Aldera Country Club has a set of lefties, the 3-wood, the 5-wood, and the driver. And I hit it mint all week.
Oh, you used your clubs
I got there. To use a lefty fucking stealth up there.
Wow.
And so, I mean, I got a little head start on this driver. I'm telling you what, people, this fucking driver adds 10. 10 really? Inches to you in the bedroom and 10 yards on the fucking golf
course. I didn't hit mine any farther, I don't think.
Really?
I don't hit it very far.
How about the sound? Sound sounds nice.
The sound sounds unreal. It looks good, too. It's unbelievable. I got to give it a couple more rounds, but I like it. And Casey sent me a new one. The first time I used it, I had a 9 degree. It was too low. Now he sent me a 10.5, but they're sexy looking for sure.
Fucking right.
So he's going to send you another lefty or you snipe
Yeah,
them?
So yeah. No, I opened up a righty the other day, right? Okay. And that was what he had. Beautiful box.
Yeah, it was nice.
I like beautiful box. Yeah, he gave me a lefty head, Obes. So I can't wait to tee it up with you.
Yeah, fucking right. Sounds like you might be moving to Seattle.
Seattle? Yeah. Are you nuts? Well, you're just saying, have you seen the fucking...
No, buddy. We don't even get that.
Seattle's tough right now.
Did you see any Missin Curfew jerseys up there? They look the same.
No, but they do have fucking Ding Tang Fung in the fucking airport, in the arena.
Ding Tang what?
Ding Tang Fung. Do you guys know what that is? It's a fucking soup dumpling place at South Coast Plaza here. One of the best restaurants ever. They have it in the barn. I sent the video of a big guy eating it. Like they got the soup and dumplings in the fucking hockey arena. Ding Tang Fung.
Game's getting soft, eh? Fuck, you can't just get a good old-fashioned hot dog or what?
Chicken wings or your chicken fried rice, Obes, pork buns.
Good atmosphere, though? Yeah, the fans up there.
Buddy, they're down 5-0. They're doing the funky chicken with fucking 4 minutes left.
I know.
They love it.
I took the Krakens against the Blues, to be honest with you. I thought the Kraken were going to be good.
They've kind of turned it around since they got their new dog as a mascot.
Smoked 5-0 against the Blues.
And then they fucking took down the Panthers, though, on Sunday.
I know, right?
Panthers had their, I don't know, they were ready to get up to Canada, I think. Vancouver, Peter Gurgis.
I don't think Vancouver's going like it used to, but.
No, it's not.
Up, dog, there's some sad news, though. Clark Gillies, the first guy who actually texted me about it was Connolly. Connolly named his dog Gillies and was like a huge Clark Gillies fan, but just a bummer, man. 65 years old. I don't know. It seems like
we're talking about young.
People dying too much here. So, 4 cups, 1,000 PIMs. Princey, do you remember watching this guy play? Or no, you're too young, aren't you? Or?
I'm a little too young, but my dad texted me, and he was my dad Tom was really upset. That was one of his favorite guys growing up. So I know who he is. You guys know my hockey knowledge. I know who he is. It was on our Instagram and our Twitter. I'm tired of tweeting out guys dying. That's all I can say.
Yeah, I'm with you. And somebody put out, so Lemieux has a camp every summer, and they put up a video from last year, the year before, of Brian Chatre strumming the guitar. And Clark Gillies singing in front of all the boys.
Like lately?
I think it was Ty Domi that put it up after Clark Gillies passed away. Yeah.
Awesome.
So Trache's playing the fucking guitar, strumming it, like real National League style.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Clark Gillies was fucking. So
could you imagine those boys, 4 cups, buddy, and just strumming the guitar and just hitting fucking Broadway?
Oh my God. They were rock stars.
Guys, fuck.
Even Long Island back then, I think, was rocking. Like they probably didn't even have to get off the island.
Well, there was no traffic probably to get downtown. And no one cared that you were fucking having a couple pints and heading back home.
4 cups, that's crazy, though. 697 points.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a sad day. He was a good fucking Hall of Famer.
Good leader, good guy. Con's name is Dog Gilly, so fuck, Con's was choked up about it, too. So
I remember.
Outer's family, we're thinking about you. And Nystrom, Eric Nystrom.
Yeah, yeah. Shout out to
him. He was pretty bummed about it, too. Obviously, his dad played with him.
Yeah,
he
looked him up like probably an uncle. Yeah.
Bummer, so. Up, dog, there's some other news in the league right now that, listen, it's not fun to talk about. I wish we didn't have to talk about it. Hopefully someday we never have to talk about it.
Well said, yeah.
Jacob, how do you spell his last name, Princey? Panetta?
Panetta, yeah.
Panetta, and with Subban's brother the other night, Jordan Subban, South Carolina versus Jacksonville. There was a scrum. He made a whatever. Either a bodybuilder, what he's saying, or I guess what Subban's saying, that he was calling him a monkey is what he was saying, which I can't imagine why anyone would do that, you know, to call someone that. So I watched this kid's video. Unless he's the world's greatest actor, he looked like he was fucking crushed and heartbroken and didn't do it. I did some digging. He's from Belleville, Ontario. I reached out to Josh Chaprica. Andrew Shaw is his cousin that played in the NHL. He came out and stuck up for this guy. Listen, there's no room in the game for racism at all. I think this kid deserves to be heard out or go through the process of, you know, going through the ECHL. He's already been kicked off the team. He's been kicked out of the league. There's going to be an appeal process. I don't know. He seemed like he truly didn't do it and felt really bad about it. And if he did do it, there's no room in the game for him. Kick him out forever. But if he didn't do it, I think he's got to be heard out here. And I hope to God he didn't do it, Uppy, because I don't think there's that many racist people playing hockey. I really don't. I don't know what you feel about it. I think what Subban, Simmer, Dumba, what's it called, Princey, the diversity club?
The Hockey Diversity Alliance.
Hockey Diversity. And Subban and those guys, listen, what those guys went through growing up, I can't imagine, right? I was a white kid from Port Hope, Ontario with 12,000 people. You know, the worst thing I got called was fat, right? What they went through, I can't imagine, you know, what they're going through. But I think what they've done away from the ice has already helped and will continue to help. And I just hope, Uppy, and I can't understand why we still have to talk about this thing. And I just hope to God that this kid didn't say something that he's going to regret, because there's no room for that shit.
Yeah, no, I think hockey has been an honest game. I think we look at comparisons amongst, you know, our game and baseball and basketball and football. And, you know, there's no question that we have a sport that is mostly dominated by white athletes. And over the course of my career, I played in the league for 16 years, Obes, played against and with, you know, some black players.
Yeah.
And there's no question that most of them grew up in, maybe white communities and dealt with, you know, people saying things to them growing up and very hurtful things. And this is something that they've dealt with. And over the past 3-4 years, I feel like, you know, we've all gone through a lot with society. Mm-hmm. Everyone's been addressed this. Everyone needs to really come out and talk about it and address the, either the issues they have from growing up and not being used to a diverse culture. But hockey, like you just said, I don't think there's room for this in hockey. I don't think there has been an issue with this in hockey. PK Subban, to me, is a very honest player. He's an honest guy. He has a great platform to speak truly for. Mm-hmm. I think he's done a lot for the black community. Mm-hmm. And for young black kids playing this game, who would have ever thought one of the best defensemen in the world was going to be from, you know, from Toronto and be African-American? He's totally set a standard for, you know, hockey and where it can go. So for me, I think... you know, Panetta is, I think he got out in front of it like he had to, because this thing was snowballing fast. And, yeah, and unfortunately, I just want to say, unfortunately, you know, there were people that jumped on this right away, and you can't really tell. Now, like you just said, I hope that everything comes out. I know that there's going to be appeal process. I know there's probably going to be, you know, somewhat of a court case on this, because this is something serious. Mm-hmm. And I hope that the truth comes out, and if it's, you know, if it's something racial, then it's addressed. And there's been a point made already, and we're all starting to go through this thing again, like you said, and it sucks to talk about, especially, yeah. I don't think there's this issue in the game. Now, if he didn't do anything, I hope that, you know, this kid's, you know, reputation just comes back, because it's tough to be a young, it's tough both ways on this.
Yeah,
it's tough to be a young kid and have now your life completely crushed for something that in a hockey play, when you're, you know, when your squirrel's loose,
yeah.
You know, and you get punched and there's a fight going on and you say something that's not racial and it gets taken out of context, that, you know, you make an act.
Yeah.
To me, it's, I don't know, man. It's a really tough spot.
I hope to God, like, for kids out there that are still playing, like, learn from it either way. Like,
yeah.
If he did it or didn't say something or whatever, just be careful. But like throughout our career, you know, and I never really heard any racism comments when I was playing on the ice, but there was some stuff said on the ice that was fucking offside. If it was about someone's wife or, you know, a guy, or, I mean, I'm not going to name guys, but there was some stuff said in playoff series where I was like, you know, and I said a few things to players that, you know, had nothing to do with race, but, you know, might have had something to do with, you know, a girl they knew at one point. You know what it's like when you're fired up on the ice, you say stuff, right? And there's no room for racism. That's where you have to draw the line. You have to draw the line there. So if this kid made the mistake, unfortunately, he's going to have to pay the price. I just thought, let's just all take a breather. I know it's a sensitive subject, Ups, and as it should be, but just let's do the right thing here and hear out both sides of the story, right? There's two sides to every story, and I think judging from his video, that's all he wanted. So it's a terrible thing. It sucks that we have to keep talking about it, Up Dog. Hopefully this will, I guess, move it in the direction that maybe we don't have to talk about it anymore. Yeah. And for Jacob, I hope you get hurt out, buddy, I hope it works out. It's a touchy subject, so.
Yeah, and PK's press conference yesterday, I mean, it was A+. I mean, he didn't, unfortunately, like, you just really feel like you had to have been there to hear it and see it. Like, the video that circulated, I don't care what anyone says, it's tough to see what happened. It's tough. Yeah. Now, you know, there is no room for it, Obes, and, you know, our world has come such a long way, and I know that we could all still do so much more for each other as a society and as friends and as brothers and as sisters. And, you know, we're all in this together with lots of love that needs to be shared. So I hope that this, you know, hockey is a great sport, and,
yeah,
you know, this is a tough look and this is a tough thing to have to go through again. So I hope we all learn from it and we all become stronger with it. Because this is, you know, these are shitty times when stuff like this happens.
Yeah, and to Subban's brother, Jordan, right? I mean, hey, I feel for him too. I'm sure he's gone through this so many times in his career that he's just like, you know, he saw something that he didn't like, and it may turn out that there was other stuff said that was way over the line, and Jacob's going to have to pay the price. But I get it. It's, you know, if you're sensitive about something and you see an action that you think is, you know, something that's happened before, you're going to act out and be pissed off. So I get both sides of the story, and or both sides of the situation, And I get PK coming to his brother's defense. I would do it for my brother too. So it's a tough situation, Updog. It's something that I thought we would address. So to both sides, it's terrible. Hopefully it works itself out. So as Jackie Moon says, everybody love everyone.
I agree.
Hey, one rule, everybody love everybody. Everybody That's love the everybody, rule I've been Updog. Going
on. Yeah, yeah. Come on, Oops.
One of my favorite teammates was color guy, Joel Ward. I love Wardle. You ever play with Wardle?
No, Toots did, and Toots loved
him. Oh, he was beauty, man. Wardle was the best. Just the best sense of humor. I love Wardle.
Toots, Toots said great words. I played against him a lot.
Yeah.
And
his
always,
whole story was great.
Fuck, he played great and hard.
Updog, and Prince, you can chime in on this, buddy. This affects your good old-fashioned Calgary Flames and being in Canada where it's really going to affect a lot of the teams. The new schedule has been released.
Oh,
fucking
sorry, Canada.
Get the groins going, boys. Get the massage therapist on line one. Get the fucking ice tub going.
It's one thing after another here.
They're going to be playing. I mean, look at this. The Flames to play 19 of 27 at home in February. They're going to play every other day up for the rest of the year, pretty much, these Canadian teams. And a lot of teams, really.
I've actually done that, I think.
Yeah, my question to you is, it could be, like, if you're a team, like, I brought this up the other day, like, let's say Princey's Flames, right? They got games in hand, right? They got 37 games played. Now, if you get on a run here, Updog, you know as a player, you want to play every night. My question to you is, if you get a little losing skid and you're fucking right in the thick of the playoffs race, you're like, man, we could use a couple days here to, you know, get away from the game. But if you're winning, you want to play every other day, Ups.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, they're 5 games in hand on San Jose, tied for that fourth, basically, spot in the Pacific.
Yeah.
The wild card. It's tough. Fuck, do we have on our rundown to talk about Sutter's comments? Because his 2 points, 1 point thing, like, he's exactly right. He's exactly right. It's fucking hard to get points. It's common sense.
I don't know, but it made my fuck. I was running around all morning. I was going Upshaw this morning with fucking shit I had to do. And Princey put that out there, and it made my morning. I just sat down. I took a breather. I'm like, I'm going to watch this clip.
Yeah.
And it was fucking priceless, right?
I think I wrote, Schools and Sylvan Lake are great.
What did he say? I don't even really know what he said. I just text Richie, or I tagged Richie and Milan and Luch. I was like, what a fucking beauty. Like, how could you not want to play for this guy? What did he say? 2 points or?
Well, the reporter asked him, he said, what are you going to take away from this big win against the Blues when you head onto the road? And he just like groaned and was like, well, when you win, you get points. Sometimes you get two, sometimes you get one. You get 2 and 60, and sometimes you get 1 in extra time. Don't make it that complicated.
Like what?
That's a guy I could play for right there.
I mean, that's so crazy. I think we just need to like go live on Instagram every time he does pressers just to get it out there.
I don't think
I might try to get a press pass and go in there and ask him questions.
Yeah,
you should. You should. We could maybe get you one.
No drinking beer in there though, eh? Not allowed to drink in the saddle, though.
I thought I would see.
You are. They're bringing it back.
Well, no wonder they fucking started winning again.
Yeah.
Two wins at home. You're allowed to drink.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. I watched the Canucks play the other night against, I think, Florida. There was more than 50% capacity in that barn, too, which I was loving.
Good.
I said that to someone. If I'm the owner of the Canucks, I'm like, just sell the tickets, all right? Don't sell the whole barn out, but sell.
Yeah.
Like, were they going to come in and count and be like, okay, you can't play, games over or what?
Well, no, they'll just make it. I think the government will make it.
What are they going to do? Give you a fine?
Maybe.
If you're the Aquilinis, you're like, fuck it, I don't care. What? Slap on the wrist? Like,
yeah.
Like, come on.
I'm filling this fucker up.
Well, you can't fill her up because like, you can, like,
cool. You could if your team was good.
Fuck, I know.
You know?
Yeah.
Right?
Hey, shout out to Bruce Boudreau, 1,000 games played, coached.
Wow.
Yeah.
Fuck, yesterday he was just starting to coach with. Now he started with Wash, right?
Yeah,
played that. That beauty's
actually started Hershey, and then he went.
Yeah,
to Wash.
So he beat us in the Calder Cup in 2003.
Yeah,
or four.
He's a beauty, man. He's a beauty.
What was I going to say about that though? Oh yeah, you know when he was a beauty was on that fucking HBO Road to the Winter Classic when he was eating the McDonald's and all that stuff, just full beauty. You knew he's a good guy.
Yeah.
I bet you that got him the job in Anaheim after that, just because they're like, do you see that beauty on? I think we got to call this guy.
What did he say to me? I went to training camp with the Ducks. I weighed in like 242 or something, 243.
That's light.
He's like, not for hockey standards. He goes, what'd you play at like most of your career there? I think I weighed 245 actually. He goes, what'd you play at? I feel good at like 235, 240. He's like, yeah, you know, you're at 245. Like I go, Yeah, I gotta be honest, Bruce. It just, you know, it didn't come off this summer like it used to. And he's like, "Yeah, I hear you. It's not as easy as it used to be.
You're like, I'll tell you what'll, you know, what'll help though is to get me on the power play here.
Fuck, he told a great story about not even knowing I got sent down.
I know. I listened to that.
He went to the rink.
You guys
the
next had great chemistry.
Yeah, he went to the rink the next day and was like, "Where's Obi?" And the guy's like, "Murph sent him down." he didn't even know.
He's like, "Fuck, I had him in the lineup."
Fuck, I was like, "God." Princey, what do you think of your Flames last night, buddy? What a match. I told you, before we came on, I said it's a lock, and you were shocked that I said that.
I was shocked. We are recording this on Tuesday, so this is Monday night's St. Louis game in Calgary where the Flames just thumped St. Louis 7-1. No, I did not expect that. I knew the road trip. I had a bunch of people DMing me being like, "So did the Updog take out the Blues? You know, they're going to have a good time in Calgary. I guess if Updog took them out over the weekend, they're going to be a little rough." So I think it was a combination of both. The Blues were definitely tired. Maybe the altitude got to them, the time change, whatever it is. But Calgary was humming last night. They looked good, really good.
Updog, I mean, when were you in Seattle with them? How many days ago? It takes a few days for the hangover to really hit. So I think the Updog probably had something to do with that Flames win.
Nah, they went into Van too and shelled Van, right? Yeah, they smoked.
They beat Van 3-1.
Yeah.
Van played their ninth goalie. You hear what happened with them with COVID protocol? They had five goalies in COVID protocol or something. They had to call up their backup from the jungle to play.
Wow.
And then they had a UBC backup goalie.
Yeah, so they thumped them.
Yeah, they beat them 3-1.
I had dinner with them on Thursday.
Yeah.
They played Friday.
Yeah, they shook that.
No excuse.
I used to hate going in and playing in Calgary on the road, though. Yeah, I get it. Fuck, I hated playing there.
They don't get hangovers like, you know, you get hangovers.
I don't know. I just never played great. Well, the only place I played good when I was going into the South Dome was with the Canucks. But that had nothing to do with me. That was just the Twins going in there and fucking dominating.
Yeah, they did own that
they
place.
They dominated that place. But Bruce Boudreaux, they did a cool thing from a Vancouver Uppy where his players came on, OV, pairs.
Saw that.
And, like, he got really choked up. So it was cool to see, like, how much of an actual players coach really like.
Hey, other coaches, awesome. Take note.
Yeah.
Fucking hard ass.
I wonder if Bob Hartley could get a tribute video from any players there, eh? I'd have a few
probably
things
one
I'd
or
like
two
to say.
That he's, you know.
I'd have a few things to say.
Yeah. I don't want to say anything I get in trouble for here.
Well, you can say whatever you want, but it's your podcast. You can say whatever you want here. So to the teams, Updog, we got lots of hockey. We've got the All-Star game we're going to talk about next week, but we got lots of hockey. These guys have been playing. Staying healthy is going to be key. Games at hand. Speaking of staying healthy and opportunities, Updog, Team Canada, the real roster came out. Princey, I still think
did yours we get
was,
on there?
I still think yours was better, Princey. I still think yours was better. Updog, the phone didn't ring, did it? You didn't get the call, eh?
Oh, I mean, fuck's sakes.
I mean, looking at this lineup, I think you should have. I think you might have had a chance. I was underestimating your ability here.
I should have really just got it going again.
We should play, like, instead of Team Canada, like, where the fuck are these guys playing now? Windbag. I know where Windbag is. He's in Switzerland making friends. He's making Swiss francs.
Again, yeah, he's in the French part.
Princey, can you help us out with this on the fly?
A few of them, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to fuck up some names here. But
where's Cracknell playing in the minors?
He was with Bakersfield.
Oh, he's just north of us. Yeah. Okay. Mason McTavish.
I know where Mason McTavish. You can go if you play in the American League, right? Wow, I didn't know
that. No, not on an NHL deal.
Oh.
Yeah. So he's back in the OHL with Hamilton.
Yeah, but you like...
So Cracknell's on just a jungle deal.
He's on a jungle deal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's what Stahl did.
Adam Tambellini, shout out to this guy. Massive shot on him. Good guy. My line mate at the Spangy. Fed him backdoor one time. He just missed.
Where is David...
Desjardins?
Where is he playing?
He's playing in Switzerland. He's good.
He's good.
Yeah. I played against him 2 years ago. He's good.
He's good player. In the Swiss League.
Yeah,
that was the little guy that played in San Jose. No.
No, he was played in Edmonton. Montreal. Good lefty, guy. Montreal. Yeah, okay. Centerman.
Okay.
Great. He's a good player.
Yeah, he is. I was thinking of the other French.
And he's a good guy. Really good guy. He broke his hand first game in Spangy. He had to go home.
Who's the guy I'm thinking of? He played in San Jose, Chicago. He's a fourth liner. His last name's kind of similar.
Desjardins?
Was it Desjardins? Was that his name?
The guy that wore number 69? Yeah.
He wore 69? Princey would know. Yeah. He's got the photographic memory going here.
Pull him up. Did he play in Chicago, San Jose?
Yeah it's him. Yeah. Right-hand shot. Yeah.
So that's a
Andrew
different guy.
Desjardins.
Yeah, that's the guy I thought. Okay. Is he still playing hockey? No. Can't be.
No.
Okay. Whew. Thank God.
This kid's nasty. Can I talk about a D-man?
Yeah.
Maxim Noro. He was our captain. He's been almost like a lifer over in Switzerland, and he's solid and a great guy. Look out for him being like, he'll be an assistant captain, I think, to, you know, if Stahl takes on the C.
Stahl's going to get the C.
Yeah, he's going to be an assistant captain. Shout out to our boy, Jason Demers.
Yeah.
Well deserved.
This was the guy I was like, fucking right. This guy's a national leaguer.
I mean, he's
this guy should still be in the show. He's good.
I agree.
There's teams that could use Jason Demers. Right-handed shot D-man.
Yeah.
Fucking can still move. I'm happy for him. Like Tyler Witherspoon, I put this kid.
Yeah.
Where's he playing? Is he playing in Europe?
One, two, three.
He's in the AHL, I believe. I just don't know which team. Gotcha. I think it was with Philly's organization.
Maybe. Are they really only taking 14 guys? I think I might still have a chance. 14 Fords?
I don't
know. They have a taxi squad, too.
Oh, they do?
There's a couple guys in there. Yeah, like that Kent Johnson guy here, he's on the taxi squad, but a bunch of other no-name.
It's crazy. Why are they so no-namers? Just send a bunch of fucking beauties over there and let's go.
Devin Dubnyk didn't make it.
Well, I think you got to still be playing, right?
Yeah, why did Devin Dubnyk not make it? Is he hurt? He has to be hurt.
No, he just got cut, man. Like,
you know what would have been epic?
That's nuts.
They just cut him.
If they would have went, hey, listen, the NHL's not going, like a year ago, let's say, went, okay. Then guys like you, listen, you got to come and live with us for 6 months and get in shape.
I know, I would have.
Travel around. Then you could have got guys that are like in their late 30s that played a long time in the show.
And that would just go to town. That had
one good last stretch of 2 weeks in them.
Yeah.
But they thought NHL guys were going.
I know.
But like,
you know
the movie Miracle? Miracle, you American boys, you love Miracle, right? Remember when Herb Brooks brings all the boys in early? If they would have done that up, dog, then totally. You could have got some old washed up fucks.
Peary, Brandon Peary. He was going to go to Switzerland, but at the time,
he's sick.
Sean Burke told him, or I don't know who was kind of leading the charge for, you know, perhaps picking the Olympic team. I know it wasn't Doug at the time. It was just like someone. But Piers was like, listen, if these NHL guys don't go, I'm going to go fucking still play in Switzerland.
Yeah.
And Piers was back in August when I went to Nashville. So, like, fuck, a couple guys could have been. I just know it sucks watching a game when you don't know anyone on the fucking ice.
Well, you ain't going to be watching it, so don't worry about it. Right? Although I may tune in to watch the old windbag go up and down the fucking left side. Right?
I know, but it'd just be better if we knew more.
I'm happy Eric Stahl's playing. That's cool.
But good luck, Canada.
How many guys last year, like Eric Stahl, played in the NHL last year that don't have a job? Because those are the guys you should have went after. They played last year. They're still relatively.
What about Marlowe?
There's just two guys.
What about Marlowe?
Yeah, what happened to Marlowe?
Jason Demers and fucking Stahl are the two guys that played. And I mean, Josh Hosang, like, this guy's got 20 fucking lives. Doesn't he?
I can't wait to watch Mason McTavish and Owen Power. Are we still the favorites, Princey, with this lineup? Or how does that work? Or like, does it go to Russia? Or do you think
we're still? I haven't seen the favorites, but I've looked at the rosters and the Russian one looks pretty good. They're all just average, but that one looks pretty decent.
They're going to be smoking cigs and just getting pinned every night.
You know what one's going to be good too? And they were good last year. They lost to Russia or last time is Germany because their pro league is really good.
I wonder if Marcel Gotch still playing?
For sure he's playing over there.
Right?
For sure.
No, I think he might own a team now or something over there.
I bet he's still playing. Can you look up Marcel Gotch for us?
Yeah, I'm looking at him though.
Gotcher gave me
retired last year.
Prince, you're running out of goals to put up of mine, but he gave me a nice little sick backdoor 4-on-4 pass in Nashville. Put that in the bank, though. Maybe save that for next year.
I got something for you. How about this?
What's up, bud?
13-year-old or 12-year-old up dog. 12 in fucking Pee Wee Quebec tournament, playing against Germany. Marcel Gotch was the captain of Germany. I wasn't a captain of our team.
Teams like that come over for that tournament?
Yeah, they get international teams from everywhere.
I thought it was just
we lost to Swiss Italy in our second year that we went there. They got Russia, Obes. They got teams everywhere.
Oh, they do.
Finland sends teams. It's not fucking just the Sweden. Canadian. No, it's called the Pee Wee International Tournament. Gotcha. Yeah. So Gotchi was nasty back then
too. Congratulations to Team Canada. Updog, I'm sorry you didn't get there. I know you were hoping to. Winnie, Winbag.
Good luck, Winnie.
We were cheering for you, buddy. Maybe we'll try to get Winnie on. You think he'll come on?
Yeah, he would.
Yeah, maybe he'll come on.
Yeah, let's text him.
If he win back. He's heard me chirping him the whole time. Updog, Brad Marchand. We got our guest coming on, Andrew Raycroft, former B, former Canuck, works for NESN. We'll ask him about Marchand. But this whole escrow, 20% chirping the Canes chirping back at him. You saw it last night. Justin Falk said, hey, I don't want to go to Canada, but we'll just go there to get these games and get the heck out of there. the Calgary Flames then tweeted at Falk saying, hey, okay, I see why he didn't want to come here because they lost 7-1. I think this social media stuff is great for the game, especially when teams, actual NHL teams are zipping back to guys. I think it's fucking unbelievable. Like that Marchand chirp about escrow from a guy who paid too much escrow, as I know you did, I thought that
it's
was
perfect.
I thought it was
what unbelievable. What did they come back to after that? Nothing. They were crickets.
He went back to the well again and went, you're still the reason why we had to pay escrow. Yeah, like he went double escrow bombs on him.
Yeah, that's like banging your girlfriend.
I just
like, hey,
I just think, finally these NHL owners and GMs are probably like, listen, social media is part of the game. Embrace it, right? Princey, how do you like it from a fan's perspective when you see guys chirping and organizations chirping and stuff like that? Do you get engaged to it or you're like, I don't give a fuck?
No, I think it's hilarious. I think it's great. It adds to social media guys like myself and all the other podcasts out there. It adds to our content because people want to see it, and it's something that we want to grab and put out there so we can share it even more. But no, I think it's great. I don't think anybody this year or even anything I can remember has really crossed the line in saying anything. I know Marchand hopped on and was chirping the Oilers about firing jerseys on the ice too. So no, I think it's great. I think if the line isn't crossed, I think it's awesome.
Hey, listen, I'm all against throwing jerseys on the fucking ice. But if I had a jersey to throw on the ice that game against Florida, I would have tossed mine too. Fuck, they had so many chances to make it 4-0 the first. That fucking Puljujarvi had two that were like, he might be left-handed. I'd come in and be like, hey, here, try I'd be like, here, try this fucking hand, bud. Try the lefty, because the righty ain't working for you. It gets in his boots, Uppy, and he like.
Listen, I called it. Fucking, he's a homer.
Oh, man, he's been awful. I tried to stick up for him. I'm sure he's a nice guy. Up, dog, staying on the I guess media side of it, but this is more media to players. Jim Matheson's up to it again. Did you see what he asked Ryan? Princey, what was he asking him?
I gotta come clean. I fooled the internet again.
It wasn't Jim.
That's a clip from 3 years ago.
Oh, you fucking got me.
I made it look like it happened yesterday.
Oh, this guy, you motherfucker.
Princey got you.
What
was it?
Listen, and the worst part is, it's not even in the rundown that I was like, I wrote down here. I'm gonna tee the up dog up with Jim Matheson.
Fuck, he's getting good at this. He tricks us too.
Hey, bud.
Yeah, tricked everybody. Yeah.
So what did he say? I missed
PA
it.
PA Parental got on there, was chirping Madison too.
Fuck. Wow.
Princey, you remember a couple years ago when the Nuge fought Monahan in that game where there was 3 or 4 fights.
I should have known this.
And I think Jim Matheson asked the Nuge, are you going to fight him again? And he was just like, what do you want me to say, Jim? Like, there's honestly, boys, there's 5 or 6 different clips that I could fire out there and make it look like he did it yesterday.
Fuck. Wow, you're a pro, man.
Right?
You got me, dude. I was like, let's rip this guy again up, dog. I got it right here. I'm like, let's rip him again up, dog. Hey, is that a new
picture? We just made a good social clip.
Is that a new picture of Hazy doing the pumpernickel behind you there?
That is Hazy behind me with the 11 fun hat that Kristen sent me.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I thought I'd make a nice little background.
What a selly that is by Scoopsy there. Look
that
at
was
that.
His hat trick.
Hat trick against Ottawa.
That was.
Well, Prince, you got me -1, O'Brien. Fucking get your head in the game. Fuck, turned one over to Princey, and Princey went, all right, Princey, you want to start playing like that, eh? You want to start fucking doing that?
I'm going to start putting some traps
okay,
up
okay, bud. All right. Well, hey, don't forget we're going to Vegas next weekend, eh? Keep your head on a swivel. You're coming into my territory, bud. All right.
I'm the one carrying the camera around.
I know, but don't remember, we got your room number, fella. We might have to do something to his room, hey, boys? Hey, a little something to his room, maybe. Marchand, keep it up, man. It's unbelievable what you're doing. Up, dog, Reevo. 2 goals against the Leafs. What'd you think? It was just great, right? Like, this is the type of stuff you got to just love for Reevo. It was unbelievable. It's nice to get your first one off.
Yeah, right? I FaceTimed him the next day. It was his birthday.
Awesome.
So he got 2 the night before and at MSG. That fucking, he's like, up dog, I had the crowd fucking chanting, Reevo, Reevo. Yeah. Sick, yeah. Right? I mean, he's made for Broadway.
Dude.
He's made for New York.
Yeah.
Huge. So, and then I was asking about Turk. He's like, when did you play for Turk? I said, Florida. He's like, oh yeah, Turk is absolutely the best. This team needed him. They're buzzing. They're fucking buzzing.
He said something about MSG too after that game. I caught. Yeah. I think it was on with Biz and the boys, and they asked about Vegas. He's like, obviously Vegas' fans are unbelievable, but there's something about playing here, original six, buzzing. So he's perfect for that city. That was unbelievable. I was a little surprised it was his first and second of the season.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I thought he was playing pretty well. Yeah. I mean, the first goal, I don't know who the D was on Toronto, but they left him fucking wide.
Just
I could have buried that one from my couch. But his second one was nice, and it hit stick, but went short side titty. He ran a few guys. It was perfect. Up dog, this guy, Chris Kreider, I told last year that the Rangers should trade him. He's got 29. 30 snipes now, Princey?
30 snipes. Yeah, he got 30 last night.
I question
how many power plays? He's been, like, just milking that fuck in front of the net.
Fuck, it's a good to milk.
That Fox is just, he's good with the puck.
Yeah.
Fox is such a good fucking playmaker. And then you got the bread man. I mean, but you get that spot in front of the net, Obes, and you got a good, like, system. Uppy, you fucking just bury
you. You could go stand in front of that net right now in your sick outfit you got on right now and just bring your stick. No one's going to touch you.
Good life, Tarp.
Put a cup on so you don't get hit in the pearls.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, no one touch you. I know.
Go to the net.
I know. It's not kids. Go to the net.
If you're in the NHL or getting called up, go to the net and just stand there. And if they cross-check you, you're going to get a power play, and you're probably not in the power play if you just got called up. But, Uppy, I watch these games, and the old defenseman in me is like, I would cross-check that guy as hard as I could right in the fucking ribs right now. I saw Parenko actually throw a couple cross-checks the other night against, who was it? And the ref?
Vancouver?
Might have been Van. I can't believe the ref didn't call it, and I loved it. I loved it. But he gave him
I mean, he could be full pronger. He's so nice. He's such a nice guy. He'll get away with everything.
Rangers are in on JT Miller, Chychrun, and Klingberg, maybe. That JT Miller, he's already played in New York. That would be a great fit for them. They need some depth scoring. Turk needs some depth scoring. Reevo, keep it going, buddy. You're great for the game. Do you see him buzzing around with a microphone trying to interview the guys in practice?
Epic.
Fuck, he was flying.
Who do you got to win the Super Bowl?
Yeah. He kept up with those guys, though. Yeah. Like, poor Groin.
He can still move. You have to for a big man.
Up dog, Colorado Avalanche. They're doing some serious fucking 16 straight. I don't know why we didn't. I knew they were going to have a run like this. And I missed it mainly because the DraftKings lines are always like minus 390 for these.
Because
they're
not dumb.
No, I
know. Teams are fucking buzzing.
I know.
First in the Central.
16 straight at home. Kyle Keefe and Raycroft, these beauties. What, I didn't get the whole, what was the Canadian beer sign about, Princey? Did you see anything into that?
Well, it's just because it was just a shot at Montreal. They had Montreal in there. I think it was like Saturday night.
Oh, they did.
They put them up on the Jumbotron holding the Canadian beer sucks sign. And I think guys in Colorado just love Keefe and Ryecroft and John Michael Lyles. I thought it was hilarious. Those guys are awesome.
They're awesome.
They've set the bar. They, by the way, set the bar for what fucking most teams need to do with their local TV stations. Yeah. Put a bunch of fucking good guys in there.
That have chemistry, that know each other, that are funny. Yeah, I agree.
Right?
I will say this. I love Kyle Keefe. He used to end up at my aftershakers every now and then. But there's a lot of things about Canada right now that aren't perfect. But our beer ain't one of them, eh, Princey?
Yeah, I saw that.
Come on, Kiefer.
Chirp our fucking country. Yeah. Don't chirp our beer.
I tell you what, Kiefer. You want to go up across the border and we'll have a six-pack of Molson Canadian.
Kokanee's.
Kokanee's my favorite.
Right? Better. Cold ones.
I had four at lunch and I was like, at Christmas time, my buddy Shane Taylor, and I was like, ooh.
It's like drinking IPA. I drink IPA so I can handle the Kokanee's.
Oh, you can, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I agree. They're great for the squad. Avs, keep it going. Uppy, I want to give some love to Delorier for the Ducks, man. This is a guy that throughout his time with Anaheim and his league, he's fought. He fought McDermott the other night. I think it's their fifth time they fought in the last 2 years. Fight of the year potential. Right now it's the fight of the year, but this is a guy you want on your squad. And I think the Ducks are going to stay in the race, but if they do fall out, if I'm a GM and I'm looking at this guy, he can play on your fourth line, he can kill penalties, and he'll fight anybody in the league. For McDermott, I guess he got a little upset. I said something about him. My boy Andrew O'Brien, who I call Meat O'Brien, who's playing in Germany somewhere for Red Bull. Munich?
Yeah. Is Munich got a Red Bull team?
I think they do. I think it's Munich.
Fucking Red Bull.
Yeah. So to McDermott, man, this guy, you know what? When he plays defense, he's pretty solid for him. Sticks up for his teammates. Exactly what the Avs needed. These are guys up dog.
Yeah, teams say they don't need that anymore.
Yeah,
are they nuts?
We still need it.
The Ducks have been playing good because of that.
What a tilt.
Right?
Yeah, that was a good old-fashioned fucking here we go.
Yeah, those knuckles.
I know, right? Oh, fuck, I just hit my knee up.
Ouch. Heads up.
I'm on the IR.
2-6.
I'm on the IR. Our next segment brought to you by our good friends at Canadips. Tied in with those two beauties, the heavyweight champs. Princey's got the current fight leaders for us here. This brings a little fucking tear to the eye here. Liam O'Brien.
Come on.
Fucking good Irishman.
Where's he playing?
He's playing in Phoenix. Great guy. Follows a Missin Curfew.
He's got the crazy hair going.
Yeah. He's got the long red hair with the beard.
Looks like a Viking. Yeah.
He's a beauty.
Is that the kid who got jumped last night playing Minnesota late?
Oh, that was Pezzetta.
Yeah, Pezzetta. Foligno grabbed him.
Foligno grabbed him. Who were they playing, though?
Montreal.
Oh, there was Montreal.
He's the guy that got called up that fought Reevo at MSG, too. That's and right. got smoked. Yeah. Kid's not scared, though. This guy from Nashville, Mark
Barowicki.
This guy's tough, I fought too, him. Man. You fought him?
I fought him.
Can we find that? Can we find that?
It wasn't perfect.
Oh, he's a killer.
He hit Barkov in our first game we had as Peter Horchek's head coach in Ottawa, and I just I went right at him and dropped him. And then he body slammed me, basically. Oh,
this is great. You found that shirt. You found that clip of Uppy and Karchi. Holy fuck, is that great? Karchi's like, fuck off, Uppy. Fuck off, Uppy.
Can you tell what I said to him? Because I forget most shit. You're
driving him crazy. He's looking like, fuck off, Uppy. It was great. This Smith guy from Detroit, man, he chucks him. Giovanni Smith, he chucks him. I respect this kid. That's something that the Detroit Red Wings haven't had a whole lot of throughout their last couple of years, yeah. Nor that they needed it.
Since McCarty.
He plays hard, yeah, since McCarty.
Right?
McCarty's a beauty.
Who else was fighting for those boys back then?
Well, I fought Brad Norton that was there for
a little while. Oh, they had Brad May.
Mayday's a killer. Mayday was a killer.
Yeah.
Both hands.
They had punches. Toots. Fuck, they had Toots.
Toots,
yep.
Toots played for the Wings? Yeah, he
fucking
did.
Fucking rights, he did.
Wow.
Yeah, he signed there as a free agent. He so left
he played Chicago, Nashville, and Detroit.
And Jersey.
New Jersey.
Marcus Foligno's been fucking.
I love this guy, man. I love OT everything winner about this games. Week.
Good for him. He's out there on the 3-on-3, eh?
So that's the current fight.
He got like 15 goals.
That's good the current him. Fight leaders. These yeah. are the Princey's got the heavies now. We got Zdeno Chara, four tilts. McDermott, Luch, Reevo, and Wilson.
Revo's fought twice this year. That's it?
Yeah.
No one wants to fight him.
Fuck. Wow.
I'll ask you the same question I was asked last week.
Yeah.
Who is now, if you had to pick one guy, who's the Bob Probert right now in the NHL?
Who's the Bob Probert?
Like tough, can play.
Chara. Chara's Bob Probert, but like George Laroque is like Reevo, and then Milan Lucic is right there too.
Yeah, I went with Luch. Just because he's got nine goals, right? Because Luch got nine
who
goals.
Who would win in a fight, yep. Luch and Chara? Like, fuck, it's
I don't think they would ever fight.
Yeah, I know, but I'm boys. Asking who would win.
Probably Chara. I don't know.
Like, Chara is just Luch. Lanky and, like, I think he can almost hold Luch to a spot where, you know, he could probably hit him.
Yeah. Who would win between Luch and Reevo?
That's Oof. Banana land.
You talk about Royal
those
Rumble.
Are going to be
you
some talk about fucking Royal Rumble. Bombs thrown.
They might want to save that one for when they retire for pay-per-view, those boys. Because I would tune in for that one, Lucic versus Reevo.
It does them no good to just... Does it do them any good to fight each other anymore? Like, man, maybe MSG. Like, you remember all the heavies used to just make sure they get at least one or two good scraps against their, you know, the yeah. other heavy. Just in, you know, does it do any good, like...
I mean, it just used to be nice when the heavies would fight as a guy that was like
the Delorier fight the other night. You don't really see like the two massive guys go at it.
No. When is Ryan Reeves and Tom Wilson going to fight this year? They play again, right? They got to fight
yeah.
once.
Oh, yeah, they play again.
Fuck.
Like Lucic and Reeves are done. They don't play anymore.
No, but let's go to schedule here. When do they play?
Oh, my God.
They played the first game of the year. They haven't played since. Here we go. February 24th versus Washington. I want Reevo to fight him in Madison Square Gardens, though. So I think that one is at MSG. Stand by.
Have they only played each other once in the first game of the year?
Right, Princey? They've only played one time yeah. this year.
Yeah.
Here we go, up dog. February 24th, Caps at fucking MSG. Reevo and Willie. They got to go there. They'll go there. Wilson will fight him.
Let's fucking go.
That'll be great. So keep chucking them, boys. Liam O'Brien, love you, fella. Updog, from our 2008-2009 year, you were playing Philly.
This is great, by the way.
This guy was a meatball of all meatballs here.
Zach Stortini.
Fuck, was he a meat stick?
I played with him in the minors.
Good guy.
He was like a friendly, like Bigfoot type yeah. guy. Like, he just is kind of like a barbarian. Yeah. Good guy.
He would fight anyone, though. You have to give him credit. He would fight anyone.
He wouldn't really win, right?
He would, like,
hang in there.
He just wasn't that great of a player.
As a Flames fan, he would seatbelt quite a bit.
Yeah.
Would he?
I played with Jared Bull.
Grab on and hang on for dear life.
Jared Bull could fight.
Jared Bull was so tough.
He had long arms.
Long arms, smart fighter, good player. Yeah.
Georgie Peros.
Georgie?
23. Oh, we didn't talk about how many fights. 25 fights for Stortini.
Wow.
Compared to what? Not le- you know, nine?
Right now, nine, halfway
so,
through.
So, I mean, yeah.
He'll probably be like 15, maybe.
Carbomb, 22. Riley Cote. Riles, 22. Eric Goddard. Do you ever play with him?
No. Played against him. And that fucking Chris Beach, love Chuck him.
Chris Barch.
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 What did I say? Beach.
Yeah. Beach, but Barch. Chris Beach played in
Chris Barch loved Chuck him.
I know he did.
Loved it. So I actually got a story about him. So we go, we're playing Sunday. So we go down Saturday night, my rookie year. He just gets called up. I don't have any idea who this guy is. He gets called up to Dallas, right? So me, Pens, Pears, we go for dinner Saturday night in Anaheim, and I fucking get in one. I get caught in one, right? So Sunday afternoon, no morning skate, just show up to the barn. So I was young. I slept in. I'm going to the rink. I'm feeling okay, but I'm not 100%, right? Like I got in a pretty good Saturday night in Newport. I come out for warm-up, and this Barch guy just gets called up, and he is working the red line. And I mean working it. And he's not taking his eyes off me. And I'm like, I go to authority after warm-up, and I go, who the fuck is this guy? And he's like, he's going to want to fight you right off the get-go. So I go in, cold water, sniffers, fucking get her going. First shift, he comes out, grabs me. I'm like, he's like, great fight. I'm like, yeah, I kind of had a late night last night. But, and ever since then, I just, every time I watch that guy play, he just works the red line and just fucking.
Always.
Win, right?
You, yeah, I play with him in Florida.
Don't he you was, have a good story about him going around the room?
He was epic. And I never told this story, I don't think, on the pod. But he, in Florida, we had this great team, but we were losing. We're getting our asses kicked. We had Jovo. We had Chris Versteeg, we had Steven Weiss, we had basically a full team of second liners and third liners. We had no first line guys. And Chris Barch takes it upon himself to call a team meeting, closes the doors, basically kicks the coach out of the room, and goes around, has his marker obes on the whiteboard, and just starts writing down. He has, you know, first line, second line, third line, fourth line. And he go, Shane O'Brien, on a good fucking team, and we're not, on a good team, what line do you play on? And then you'd be like, I don't know, second line. He's like, wrong, fourth line, boom. And he'd right there. And then he went around to the next guy, like, Steven Weiss, you might be our best player. And you've been on the first line here for how long? But your teams have sucked. So what line were you playing? Second line? No, wrong, third line, boom. And then, like, he said something to Versteeg, and Versteeg was like, fuck you. You know, he stands up, and of course he goes over to Jovo, like, Jovo, I respect you, but, you know, you're not a fucking top 2D on this team. No chance. He's our
captain. So he ripped everyone.
Everyone. He just went around and ripped everyone. Now, basically, to the point of you're not a first liner, so don't act like you don't have to back check, or you can just fucking hang on to the puck. Like, he was like, you know, Steeger, you got probably the greatest hands I've seen, you know, forever. It's like, blah, blah, blah. But you fucking don't back check, all right? And then you get upset when you don't play on the power play. You're not a fucking first liner. And he went through with this whole thing. And I, you know, Uppy, you take too many fucking penalties, all right? I'm like, shut up, fucking guy.
Shut up. Shut up.
You know, shut up, Barchie. Fuck.
So he basically was saying, that's hilarious, by the way. He was basically just saying, hey, we all got to play harder.
Like third liners, and yeah, we win. We might be able to win if we fucking all play like a same, if the, yeah, we just can't act like one guy's better than the next.
Yeah.
And it made a lot of sense. Like, it's a good way to think of it.
What line you on? Second, wrong, fourth line. Wrong, fourth line. We had something similar. That is legendary. Fuck, that'll be a good social clip for the boys there. We kind of had the same thing, but it was AV, my second year in Vancouver, and Matthew Schneider. Do you ever play with Schneider? You know Schneider through the PAs?
Yeah, I play with him in Phoenix.
So Schneider doesn't really play, and we got 8D. Anyways, AV comes in the room, and he goes around the room, like, achieving, you know, Luongo, achieving, O'Brien, underachieving, like, around the whole room, achieving, underachieving, not bad, underachieving. And then he does the last guy, and then that kind of quiet little, like, you know, and then Schneider goes, well, what about you, AV? What would you give yourself? And the whole room just kind of went, like, I can't believe he just said that to the coach. And then AV, he made AV answer the question. And AV was like, I think I'm underachieving. After, I was like, Schneider, that was legendary to hold him accountable like that. But you don't see that with the veterans nowadays. There's no way they would say that. Barchi, you're a beauty, buddy. That story was unbelievable. Up dog. Congrats to Keith Yandle. Ops, 964. That crazy. Is a lot of fucking games, man.
I play with Yans. He was great. Wow, I love playing with Yans.
It's a lot of games.
You talked about him yesterday on your show with Cooley. Great guy. Obviously, man, it doesn't matter who you are in pro sports. To play that many games with, you know, the pucks off the feet and the fucking stick in the teeth and no teeth and come back to play the next day. And geez, just... How about just trying to play with the fucking, when you got the runs sometimes?
Yeah. I chirped kind of Marlowe last year when he broke Gordy's record. And you know, Jans, no, he doesn't play physical, but like to play 964 straight, you're going to have to play through a sore groin or a bad elbow or a sore shoulder, or your hips fucked, your back. So no matter how physical you play or not, to play that many straight has been unbelievable. I can't believe what's going on in Philly. It's crazy up, dog. But Jans, congratulations.
What is going on in Philly, bud?
I don't know. We don't have time to get into that.
Two 10-game losing streaks.
They cost me a 5-team parlay last night is what they fucking cost me.
Why? I went 4-5.
They lost. Stars, 3-1. You can't lose every game, can you? I'm like, they're going to win. They'll beat Dallas. Dallas isn't
that good. You know, I mean, if you've ever been on a team like that, it's tough to get out of that stench.
Is it? Even at home? I don't know. Yeah, you're right.
Time for new ownership, I think, there. Yeah. Just clear out the ownership. Sell the team to someone, some crypto kid that just made fucking whatever. Sell the team. I don't know. What about those guys that just sold Activision to Microsoft for fucking $70
billion? Yeah,
okay. Why don't those guys buy the Flyers?
What is that, like a video game company or something, right?
Yeah, Microsoft. Yeah, the Call of Duty. Call of Duty.
World of Warcraft.
World of Warcraft. Call of Duty. Fucking 70 bananas, not you know, the 70
fucking,
billion.
Well, how come my Microsoft stock's getting fucking demolished? And is that why? Because they spent $40 billion or what?
It's a little sell-off.
Yeah, I guess it is a little sell-off. Fucking selling everything. Updog, hockey talks, Bell Let's Talk, sorry. January 26th, Princey, is that right?
Yeah, January 26th.
So Kevin Bieksa and Wes Rippon, Rick Ripper's brother, dropped the puck the other night. I played with Ripper in Vancouver for 2 years. I witnessed some firsthand struggle. I witnessed some firsthand, which I thought get through it his second year, where I hung out with him quite a bit and we did lunches together, and he seemed happier, right? And you know, a lot of hard work went into it. We supported him. And then he ended up taking his life. So it's sad. I love playing with Rick Rippon. I still miss him to this day. Everyone does. To Juice, Bieksa, you know, good on you for, you know, still going up there and doing that stuff. And it's still something, Uppy, mental health in sports in the world, it's something we can't forget about.
Yeah, that's well said, Obes. I think we've all been around, you know, some sort of unfortunate situation where, you know, we all felt we could have done a little more to people we love, to others that we don't know. But I think this does shine some great awareness, especially in the hockey community, on, you know, just how important it is to communicate and to speak and to ask questions and to be there for your brother, your teammate, your family, your friends. Yeah. You know, Toots is always a well outspoken, you know, advocate for this and for the Indigenous community up in Canada. And, you know, it means a lot for people to put in a little time and recognize just how important, Obes, that this, you know, this sort of thing is in our world, you know.
Absolutely. And well said as well. And if anyone out there, if you're struggling, go talk to somebody, right? Reach out to them. There's nothing wrong with it. There's been times throughout my career where, you know, I'd go talk to sports psychologists about stuff on the ice, off the ice. If you need help, go get it. There's nothing wrong with it. We've all need to, you know, let loose and talk to people at times. So Ripper, I still miss you. To the Canucks, 10th year doing that. It's unbelievable. Bell, Let's Talk. So Uppy, our final segment before our guest is Good Life National League Tarps, presented by our boys at Good Life. You got a nice Good Life tarp on there.
I do.
Both salmon? Of them, or which one? Oh, salmon, yeah.
Salmon, baby. The V-neck.
It's a nice V.
I actually almost dropped my lunch on it today, though, so that would have been tough.
What'd you have in there? Some soup or something?
No,
or?
I had a little Korean. It was called East Burrow, right over there. Great salad.
With the noodles. East Burrow, where's that?
It's up right here? At the camp here, right?
Oh, have you
guys
it.
Ever? Hey,
you love dinner. This guy loves the camp.
Oh, yeah, the camp's good.
East
yeah.
Burrow, though? Fuck, what a spot.
Is
you
it
get
good?
The egg rolls.
Oh, wow.
It's nice. Little Korean fucking place, yeah.
Up, Doug, I was watching the games here, and I've been watching the old teams wearing the darks on the road.
Old school.
I don't like it. Yeah.
You don't like it?
We grew up that way.
What do you like better, whites or darks?
I like the darks at home. I don't think I can go back. Detroit did it on the Cali trip. Colorado did it because LA's got these white jerseys that do fuck.
The white jerseys are unbelievable. And I want to see the black.
Do you like them at
I want to see the black.
Yeah.
The Kings jerseys are the best. And about, I have. I'm wearing one next
time. How about Pittsburgh's jerseys with the Pittsburgh across the chest too? I like that. Like that.
Pit? Yeah, sideways
the
pit.
The black ones, yeah. What did I say? Diagonal?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
I just don't think it looks as good on TV. And we talk about making this game... I guess it doesn't matter. Maybe, Princey, I'm thinking too much into it. What do you think about when you watch I don't know. I guess maybe I'm just used to it. With time, it would get better. I like the darks at home, Princey.
Yeah, no, I think it's good. I think it'd be a good balance. I think I'd like to see more teams do it a little bit more often. I don't know if I'd like to do it full time. Like, I'm trying to think, maybe 2002, 2003 was probably the last time that they did whites at home full time. But I wouldn't mind seeing some teams wearing whites at home if it's a third or whatever it is. I think it's different. It gives it a different look. So I'm all for it, but I don't know if I'm for it full time.
I like to mix it up. I like for the, you know, my young kid to go to the game and him not see the same jersey on. I think the whites are nice. You know,
you like the whites?
I don't mind it at home. Okay, I just think, right. You know, if the fucking team comes and they forget their white jerseys, they got to wear dark. You know, the trainers fuck up and they bring the wrong ones.
Yeah.
The other team's like, fuck it, we got this.
Yeah, that's true. That's
sell
true.
More jerseys at home.
And I do like.
Well, this got announced today, boys. Sorry to jump in there.
No, get in there.
It's not on the rundown, but this got announced today that the NHL is bringing back the reverse retros for next season, whether the teams want to make adjustments or want to use the ones from the season priors. But next year, the reverse retros are coming back.
Oh,
I do want to say one thing about my trip to Seattle. Yeah. The colors in the rink are awesome. Like, you know, that SoFi Stadium of vibrant colors.
Yeah.
What they've done with the colors of their jersey and just their gear, like, they got great swag. In fact, I wanted to grab this one sick hoodie. In fact, we should look at what it was and put it on, get a Missing Curfew one. Awesome gear.
Now you're talking.
It's a shout out to, you just want to have nice fucking clothes at your spot. You don't want to leave with like a shitty tarp, you know?
I like their unis. I mean, I just, I don't love their squad.
No, their squad's tough.
I just think they could have been good. All those things that you're saying, I agree with. I just think if their team would have been in a playoff hunt now. Like,
so what? That's what everyone asked up there. Like, those guys are sitting round table like we would at Big Canyon, nice big eight-man table. And they're like, what's wrong? I'd love to get your input on the Kraken. And it's, you know, either Ron Francis is a complete idiot or he's a fucking genius.
Yeah.
And after this season, he's got 1 year to basically show you what his plan was. And it might be just to gas all these one-year deals and have a shitload of money to spend on, you know, who's going to be a restricted free agent that can't afford it. And you hammer them with an offer sheet. And then you fire two deals at these guys that can't be, because this flat cap, teams are going to get pinched. I think teams are going to get pinched trying to qualify guys. And they're going to come at this second wave of offering deals to guys. So he's either an idiot or he's a genius.
Yeah, I think he's hoping that in like 2 or 3 years when the cap goes back up, that he's going to be like, teams are still going to be in one. And he's going to be like, okay, I can sign guys now.
You think if he gets a couple-year deal? I don't know. I think he's got to turn it around quick or people aren't going to show up.
I don't know. I think he must have ran it by the ownership and be like, listen, this is a 5-year plan, because it ain't turning around quick. No. I don't think. I mean,
no,
they're fucking in one. They play hard. They got good character.
No, like, they don't shoot the fucking
puck. I love Yanni Gourde.
They don't shoot the
puck.
What
he did the other night fighting your boy Gudis, that was unbelievable.
I know. That was
unbelievable.
Great.
Yeah. I loved awesome. It. It was awesome.
Center ice. He said, fuck it, let's go.
Yeah, it was great. So I think they got Schwartzy, great character.
Schwartzy
they got
is
some
a great
good guys
kid.
In there.
Yeah.
They just need some guys that can put the puck in the net. Up, dog, the Buffalo Sabres are bringing back. Remember how awful those black,
the
red.
Black, the Hasek ones?
Yeah,
with
but
the fucking
now I saw a picture
there.
Of them. I thought they looked pretty cool.
They had the bull on the front.
Yeah, not the saber, right? Is it a bull? What is it, Princey?
It's a bull.
It is a bull, right?
It's a buffalo.
It's a buffalo head.
Didn't you score your first goal on Hasek?
I did, yeah, a little blocky.
No big deal.
My point is, remember these jerseys that we thought were shit? They come back, like Arizona's, right? Remember back in the day, the ones they're wearing now,
yeah,
everyone thought
Tuchuk
they were terrible?
Yeah, Tuchuk and Mellenby, that one's Roenick.
I think they're awesome now,
the
ones
they're
wearing.
Yeah, they look
good. So it's just like,
I
guess everything.
You're just sick of watching hockey. And
I think everything just comes full circle is kind of what I'm saying. And then there's some squads here, Princey. Who needs a little facelift in the league, bud?
Well, I want to open this up to you guys, too, but I threw out a couple names here that I think these teams might need a little facelift. I know we were talking about the Kings. Their jersey looks so much better than what they've got now. I think they should go back to their 90s ones. And, like, should the Ducks go back to purple? Like, is that an Orange County thing? You guys are the ones that are there. And my other one, I would say the Winnipeg Jets. I don't like their jerseys at all, but I love their heritage ones. So I think that there's some teams that probably could use a full facelift, kind of like what the Coyotes have done, what the Flames have done, what a bunch of other teams have done.
Yeah, I'm with you. I don't know. I wouldn't mind the Ducks going back to the eggplant and teal. I like those back in the day. They wore them for the retros a couple years ago, right? I think I like the Colorado ones, the ones they wore last night. I guess it would be their third ones, right? With the
It says Colorado right down the
It has like a triangle thing in the middle.
It's got like the color, like state emblem.
That's the state emblem. It's on all the license plates.
Yeah, I think those are cool.
Yeah. Yeah, they're good on hats.
Swag, babe. We were always looking to make the league look a little nicer. Hey, Updog, that was presented by our good friends at Good Life. Speaking of friends, DraftKings, baby. Top titty. Who is the winner here? Josh Allen.
Wow. Josh Allen.
We had one Josh Allen
Not win. The quarterback, because he didn't win, unfortunately.
I DM'd him, but he didn't.
But Josh Allen, congrats.
He's friends with Big Sexy, right, Princey?
Yeah, yeah. I got a hold of the real Josh Allen before the show, and he's friends with Big Sexy out in Boston, so he was pretty fired up.
Big Sexy.
Updog, we really dropped the ball this week. We were two things away from being sold out.
I can't tell you. PJ, I was golfing in cold weather, obviously, and fucking PJ told me four times, get your top titty. And I tried and I tried, and then it messed up. Unfortunately, I think the service sucked. And then at 3:59, I'm telling you, bud, wouldn't go through.
I didn't even cross my mind.
It said game started. I said, shit.
Obi, you were in here.
Was I in here?
You shared the top titty thing on Instagram.
Yeah, I know. Then I went and played golf. I should have done it from here.
I think we both shared it because I shared it too. I was ready to rock. I was on there.
Did you send it in the group text?
I did not, but I saw you shared it.
Oh, fuck. Let's go, bud.
What are you blaming it on me for?
Well, come on, hey? Hey? I'm not blaming you. I'm just saying I lean on you for the Friday text with top titty on it. Right?
Activate the fine fund in Vegas. You both of you.
Yeah, we'll activate the fine fund. No, but listen, maybe we have I'll tell you when we won't miss with a little extra on the line. Let's get DraftKings to bump it up a bit.
Yeah, I would love that.
Hey, a little 10 spot maybe for the next one.
Binger.
Let's get a $10 game going.
Fucking Binger, 28th place.
Binger's been
Who'd
buzzing.
You take, Binger? Who'd you have that was so good, fella?
I got no clue.
He doesn't know.
I feel like you're standard always in the mix. Like 69th place, pretty good.
Won $6, you know, won my money back.
I feel like you're always like right in the mix of her.
I think Max has his own like basically sports algorithm thing he's got going on over
Princey,
there.
Princey, 91st.
I'm literally always in the middle every single time.
I think we expect more from Princey, don't we, on that one, Updog? You know, he's our guy up there.
Huh.
I went Panthers and Lightning, and both of them only got one goal.
And then our boy A-Hall, he's good at a lot of things in life, A-Hall. Top titty ain't one of them. Hey, A-Hall, he's always like dead last. 39 points. Did he miss a couple guys? We almost beat him. We didn't even play.
Yeah.
He's busy. He's trying to keep this whole thing together for us. So Josh Allen, congratulations. Big Sexy, we love you, baby. Get out here. I want to see you. DraftKings, Saturday night, lock of the weeks. The Updog.
Why don't I just follow this on my bets?
The Updog has turned into a survivor pool.
But I mean, a survivor, and I'm 8-2, man.
Prince, he's 500.
Yeah, I climbed just back up.
I'm buzzing, Jake Muzzin.
All right, who we got, boys? Who we got here? So, Prince, you get to go first, right? Because you're last place.
I like that.
Or it doesn't matter really, right?
Well, because we all three of us won again. So that's back to back weeks. So if we do it like we did last week, then Updog gets to go.
I got a lock of the week here. And Obi, you can't pick him.
I can't pick him if you pick him, right?
Well, no, it just says on here you can't pick him.
Oh, gotcha.
Sharks at Panthers. Check cheddar like a food inspector.
Oh, you're taking Florida.
Done. Circle that shit. What do you think about that?
I don't know what to think.
Saturday. They're coming off a long road trip, though.
I can't take the Hurricanes. Princey, if you know what you're going to take, go ahead.
Might be a bad bet.
I will. I do know what I'm going to take, boys, and everybody's going to chirp me online because they know it's predictable. I took them once. They lost. Flames. I'm going back to the Hockey Night in Canada. Well, Calgary over Vancouver at the Dome.
You're just banking on Calgary getting a win here sometime.
Yes, I am.
Although they did win twice this week, so good on them.
I'm going to take the Oilers going into Montreal.
Good pick.
Do you think the Oilers can turn it around?
I think they can beat the fucking Montreal Canadiens.
Yeah, they can beat Montreal. I don't think it
turns around. I think the Canadian Olympic team might be able to beat the Montreal Canadiens. They're fucking in one. Updog, Princey, we got a great guest coming at you. Andrew Raycroft, Razor, coming up next.
Big fella, it's time for those Larry Loves of the world. It is Valentine's Day coming up, my friend.
Good time to be single.
It is.
Good time to be single.
It is. You don't need to worry about all that one-on-one type bullshit.
Go have a drink somewhere. If you see someone else by themselves on Valentine's Day, you got a chance.
It's what you call Hallmark.
Got a chance.
It's a Hallmark day. But anyway, roses are red, violets are boners. So don't let your boner get any of those pubes around it. Why would you? Valentine's Day is just around the corner. And our sponsors at Manscaped Big Fella are here for you and our listeners with the best tools to get your balls ready for the special occasion.
Gotta have the balls trimmed up for Valentine's Day. I'll be single or not single, whatever. You gotta be ready to rock. This V-Day, it's time to join the full 4 million men worldwide. 4 million up, dog. Who trust Manscaped, the leaders in the below-the-waist grooming. With our exclusive offer, go to manscaped.com and use code
Curfew
for 20% off and free shipping. 4 million guys.
Do you think there's 4 million guys out there whose old ladies trust them?
I don't know, but 4 million guys with their balls and nuts looking good. The girls are lucky nowadays.
I think so. I think clean balls are very important on Valentine's Day. Why? Because you don't want to come home from dinner after giving her nice flowers and a gift, getting lucky, and you know, she goes down there and ends up having, you know, stragglers in her teeth. You don't want that.
That could ruin a Valentine's Day, couldn't it?
Yeah, imagine getting the pube mustache going. You don't want that.
And I would say for you married guys, this is probably the one night where you're guaranteed that your wife, no matter how much she doesn't want to sleep with you, she's going to have to.
Get lucky.
Get the fucking lawnmower humming and get the fucking balls looking good to get ready to rock. Because you know, Uppy, I think if you're married, the old lady's going to she's not saying no on V-Day.
I agree. And why not make like the 13th of, you know, the night before Valentine's Eve, why not make that the national shave your fucking ball sack day? Just so you're nice and fresh. Get that toner on. Get that toner going. I mean, Manscaped, they has it all. Products for just about anything for a night like this to make your V-Day date safe. Wow, what a great set of balls you have there.
Get 20% off and free shipping with the code
Curfew
at manscaped.com. That's 20% off with free shipping at manscaped.com and use the code
Curfew, baby.
Join Cupid and shoot your arrow with Manscaped this Valentine's Day. Welcome back to Missin' Curfew. Up, dog. Another legit national leaguer from our era.
From your area. Bell Vegas.
Little Texas back in the day. Razor, he stayed out of Little Texas. That's why, you know, he won the Calder. He had a good career. He stayed away from me and Richardson early on in his career. But one of my favorite teammates, 2004 Calder Cup winner, Andrew Raycroft. Razor, thank you, fella.
Yes, thanks for having me on. I've been waiting this call with bated breath, excited to hang out with you guys.
And we use the term on the golf course a lot, smoothie Douglas, when a guy has a nice buttery swing. This guy is Uppy, the ultimate smoothie Dougie.
Like on and off?
Like, oh yeah, on and off, oh yeah. He's cool as the other side of the pillow.
Oh, but you're talking on the course.
I'm talking like his back doesn't hurt after the round probably, right? Razor, does your back even hurt?
No, he's a goalie.
Not much force. It's a little flat in the back, a little Matt Kuchar-esque, but
Slow and steady. Sure. Slow and steady, long swing. So did you guys grow up golfing?
A little bit, but Razor, you were more like, when I was training in Belleville with Jason Saprica, and you'll love this, we had Richie on a couple weeks ago, and I called Soupy's thing 4-to-1 fitness, and then I chirped about how much he charged me. He like texted me, he's like, you probably spent more this weekend than what I charged him. I'm like, Soupy, it was a fucking joke. But I think you were spending your summers in Boston then, right? You'd only come home for a little bit.
Yeah, I was like that 2002, 2003, right when you guys were starting to make hay. I was down here a little bit more. I had burned my Belleville summers out already and needed to clean my act up and stay down here and get in the gym. So I didn't just hang out with Obes and play golf every afternoon and skip out on my 5-to-1 workouts.
Yeah. Black Bear, Trillium Woods, and then right to fucking Little Texas that night. Was Richie for about 3 or 4 summers. But
I've only drove through town on the way to Kingston. Stopped at the local, what did I stop at? The local alcohol store?
LCBO.
I stopped at the LCBO. Grabbed it.
He started right on North Front Street.
No, he stopped at the one in Port Hope, actually, and he took a piss on the side of it.
Sent him a video. I'm like, I'm on my way to Kingston
to watch this
Tragically Hip show, and I was completely gooned at the time. I'd spent the whole afternoon on a boat with our boy Travis, And sure enough, in the Sprinter van, I see this fucking, you know, Trans-Canada Highway sign with Port Hope. And I'm like, no fucking way. I'm stopping at Oakley.
Gotta take a peek.
Right? I'm taking a peek. I would have stayed the night. I would have called Pitter and said, Pitter, let's fucking go.
You would have got a kill, but it wouldn't have been your best one. I'll tell you.
No.
It wouldn't have been one you'd tell the boys at home about. But hey, one thing about Razor, before we get into the bees, Razor, when he would come home to visit his family when we were skating, you know, this is probably right after you won the Calder or whatever, he'd come out, Bruins gear. And right, we'd come in and guys would rip a couple high on your Razor. Razor would be like, fuck it, that's it. Off he goes. Like, done. He's like, I'm like, boys, you got to keep him down on Razor. Remember that?
Yeah, I thought I was a veteran national leaguer at that point. I wasn't going to let you junior guys go high and hard on me.
I'm like, I didn't score on him anyway, so it's okay, boys. I'm looking to get my confidence up here. So.
Well, and it was always Richie. He was such a little weasel. Like, they always Richie. They're just giggling and thinking it was funny.
I know, right? He ripped him high and hard. Me and Richie every summer, at least once or twice, would get in like a fuck you where I cross-checked him and be like, what are you going to do, Richardson? And he doesn't talk to me for a couple days. And then I text him. I'm like, yo, we going a little Texas tonight or what's going on?
Razor, let me just go back. Obi, obviously, on the introduction said you won the Calder Cup in 2004 with the Bruins, which is amazing. It's something for a young rookie to, you know, that trophy's always yours, which is amazing. But take us back to... you know, being a rookie, you're playing with the likes of, you know, Joe Thornton, Samsonov, Mike Knuble. I play with noobs. But, you know, what was it like to be a young guy and you know, compete for, you know, for a hell of a franchise like the Bruins back when you were a kid?
Well, it was amazing. And, you know, we touched just as we were going on. So I had played 3 years pro before that. So I was like the pre-lockout rookie of the year guy. You know, when guys actually had to go to the minors and ride the buses and grind it out in the jungle, I was one of those guys. So I played my first National League game in 2000, actually, right out of junior. Couple injuries in front of me, it allowed me to play right away out of junior. And then I took me another couple years to figure it out in the minors. And so being around those guys, you know, having Joe Thornton when he was, you know, a year older than me, but it felt like he was 5 years older. And even watching him in junior, I mean, the guy was a man child. So to hang out with him and sit in his apartment and stay in his apartment while I was 20 years old was the dream come true. I really could have finished my career then. I mean, that was as good as it got, but like I said, grinded away, and then to be able to win Rookie of the Year, to have that NHL trophy, like you guys know, is pretty special.
Yeah, you're looking good in that pick too. Hey, you had the hair flowing, you had the hair off. I remember the pick, Razor. Hey, did you have a nice little bonus for that Calder back in the day? Did you have that slipped in there?
I had a bonus, but it's not as good as the entry level bonuses that the boys used to get back in the day. That was a good part of the NHL back then.
Fuck,
the
stockpiled.
Rookies got paid.
My contract loopholes, they were just stockpiled. They weren't paying you a whole lot in salary, but fuck, if you hit those bonuses and if you were good, you hit them.
You got $1 million check right before you, like, right? You got $1 million.
Signing bonus was $1 million for the 3 year. But then I think the performance bonuses is what we're going to talk about. That's if you hit 20 goals, it was like 250. If you hit, you know, and there was a 7 goal segment basically. Like if you hit the 20 goals or 35 assists, or you were the top, you know, 4 in ice time and you clip 2 out of the 7, you got them all. It was like a crazy, you know, form of paying out these kids. Nowadays, they just get paid in their second contracts.
You knew who got some big bonuses before Chris Gratton. Gratz is always like, to tell me the bonuses. Gratton's got. He's like, too much, guy. I'm like, Gratz, how much make your bonuses? Too much, guy, too much. He made like outrageous amount of money.
Yeah, those guys, you know, he was probably $10 million by the time he got out of his first 3 years. Mine was front loaded. I hit, like I said, I was playing games, so I did get some of those bonuses. I had a good signing bonus out of juniors, which guys don't get now. Like you said, you know, you're chasing $1 million coming out of junior. That was a good deal. But for me, winning Rookie of the Year, I was on my 4th year. Oh, so I was out of my entry level.
That's
so
a joke.
My bonus was like $100,000, where it had been the year before, I would have been, you know, $600,000, $700,000, $750,000. So that was a bit of a kick in the teeth, especially because I had to tell everybody that, because back in the day, like you said, Uppy,
yeah,
everyone asked you that. Like,
totally. It was common knowledge. Yeah.
By every player after I won it, and I had to tell them why I wasn't that good. So it was more of a shot to my ego than my bank account at that point.
So you had played the 2020 in like a couple years before, but who did you end up like beating out? Who were the runner ups for
rookie of the year?
Yeah. That year.
Yeah, so I had Michael Ryder and I had Trent Hunter. So all three of us were 1980 birthdays. We were all 23 years old. We were the old rookie guys. Like, realistically, nowadays, we'd probably never have a chance at rookie of the year. But we can all say we were finalists.
You might have beat those two guys in the fastest skating contest, dude, with your goalie gear on. Those could be two of the slowest guys I've ever played against. Ryder just come down the wall. I'm like, oh, this is a nice tempo here. I can hit.
Yeah, he's slowing it down, and then heads
trying
up.
Trying to snap one through your shin pad. Yeah. That's all he was trying to do. He wasn't going to beat you wide.
Razor, you brought up Jumbo, and I have him down here as my question, so I'll ask you right now. What when you see him still playing, and you know, we've had guys on from the Panthers, Uyghur, Montour, guys like that just love Jumbo and say that when he still comes to the rink, Razor, he's still like upbeat, having fun. Like it's unbelievable.
It is. It's amazing. And you knew that about Joe right from the start. You always heard about what a happy-go-lucky guy he was. I think what's changed is, you know, his ability to be a pro too at some point. And I think that was one of the reasons they when he left here, I think that helped his progression, helped his leadership. But at the time here, I mean, it was priceless. We'd play Risk, you know, that war game, board game. And it's like the Seinfeld episode where he had one of his buddies from home. We called him the butler, and he lived in the closet with a Canadian flag over in front of him, took the door off the closet and put a flag out in front. And he had to like sit there while we practiced and watch the board and make sure no one moved the pieces. You know, it was just crazy stuff like that we were always doing. He was always so generous and so happy, just a happy person to be around as a young guy. And then of course, you put in what kind of a hockey player he was and what he was in the mid 2000s, how big and strong and long and talented he was just such a marvel to watch every day. And you knew he was going to be a Hall of Famer. I don't think anyone pegged him at playing for 29 years like he's doing right now. But at the same time, now I look back and I see him doing it. I can only imagine how much fun he is to be around right now as an old 43-year-old guy.
Yeah, and I don't know if you guys ever had this, but like, if there was one guy in the NHL that I could have like switched spots with, right? I was always like Jumbo, like, right? Yeah. Like, didn't wear a visor, 6'4", can chuck him if you want to, 6 style, tongues out, works the half wall, doesn't really back check a whole lot.
No, plays like, at his own pace.
All his teammates love him. I'm like, I would be, if I could switch right now to Time Machine, I'd be Joe Thornton. Like, yeah, that's the guy I would always want to be.
Smart. Yeah. I remember having a conversation with David Poile when the trade went, you know, Jumbo to San Jose. And he was like, what do you think about the trade? And I was like, I mean, I don't know. I think Joe Thornton's like the best player in the world. Is he like one of them, isn't he? And he's like, you always win a trade when you get the best player out of the mix, right? And he's like, that's a fucking hell of a trade. So
still working for that guy too. Say what you want about Poile. Yeah. I ripped him last year, and we're gonna have to talk about the Predators. Like, he picked up Duchesne and Johansson with people like, what are you doing? So maybe that method still works for him.
It is working. And then I had dinner with a couple guys from the Panthers this past weekend. And just to touch on what you said, like, he was that fun to be around when he's younger. And now at this age, and we all went through years of our older, you know, career adolescence where we're like enjoying things that much more because you don't know how much longer it's around for. And they say Jumbo is like awesome. Like, he's there in the room, he's staying late, he's hanging out with the younger guys. And I actually asked Hubie, I'm like, what's the difference between him and Yogs, right? Because Yogs was there at that point in his career too, helping out Hubie and Barkey. And they're just like, he's just more involved. Like, he's engaging more, he speaks more. Yogs was always doing his own thing, but yeah. It's just awesome. So it says much
and that,
about him.
To that point, that was the one, the funny thing. It was almost a knock on Joe, I think, because he loved the boys. He loves being around the boys so much. And he never wanted to take the superstar mantle. He always just wanted to be one of the guys. And at the end in Boston, I think they wanted him to be the guy who told everyone what to do. And they wanted him to be the one to – This is a Mike Keenan story really quick. I know this isn't like complete story time, but Mike Keenan was the – I had Pat Burns and Mike Keenan the first three months of my NHL career. So imagine being a 20-year-old goalie having Pat Burns yell at you. He didn't even know my name. He just called me kid for the first 4 months. He gets fired. 2 days later, Mike Keenan comes in the room and makes me ride the bike for 65 minutes after every game I'm playing. I'm dying to get out of the National League because I hate this guy so much. Can't ride the bike for 60 minutes after every game anymore because I'm already 140 pounds. I can't take anymore. We have a meeting in Detroit. I'll never forget this. Meeting in Detroit, pregame meeting. Like I said, I'm 20 years old. I'm just trying to not be seen. Don't want anyone. I got Bill Guerin in the room. I got Joe Thornton, all these guys. Mike Keenan calls me up to the front of the room. He says, is Joe Thornton going to be your captain for the next 15 years in this league?
Wow.
And I said, well, of course, yes. And meanwhile, Jason Allison's the real captain sitting right beside me too. He hates all the young guys. So now I'm really screwed because he's going to hate me. And he left me up there for minutes, felt like hours. Oh. And then he sat me down. I said, no, I don't think he's going to be in front of everybody. And then moved on. So that was like what was going on. There was an undertone of that with Joe the whole way. And I think it was just misconstrued and him wanting to be one of the guys.
You got Babcocked.
I just wrote that down. That's what Babcock did to Marner. That is so fucking gutless. How a coach thinks you could pull up a young kid in front of grown men and ask him that question. Like,
that's crazy.
I used to have a little bit of respect for Keenan, but now I think it's all gone out the window.
Iron Mike.
Fucking gutless.
Iron Mike. He was at the Flyers alumni game with me and Loops. He was working the bench.
No way.
Fucking Iron Mike was there, yeah.
How's his hair? Is he got any pieces left up
there? That's great. It's going on him.
You got to give him that. He'd still do the comb over late in the career. I don't know.
Let's talk about, let's switch a little bit. You had Patrice Bergeron on your team as a rookie. This kid... Oh, this Hall of Famer, call him a kid.
Animal.
You call him whatever you want. He has come so far and done so much for this league, for his team, for, you know, the game itself, for our country, Canada. Like, he's just an all-around unbelievable player. What was this kid like as a rookie, you know, growing up? And then did you think he'd turn into what he has today? Like, he's Mr. Selke. Like, he is the...
Like, never makes a mistake.
He is the guy.
Fuck.
He's literally, like, you talked about who you want to be when you grow up and you talk about Joe Thornton. Patrice Bergeron's literally the perfect human being.
Yeah.
All of those things you talk about on the ice, he's better off the ice. And I cannot tell you it's not an exaggeration. He's literally perfect. And to that, I was lucky. I was his roommate. I was his first National League roommate. Him and I were the two young guys, you know, the two quiet ones. Joe Thornton, our top line centers were Joe Thornton and Patrice Bergeron. It was pretty good in hindsight, all world team. 18 years old, second round pick, when 18-year-olds didn't play back then.
Yeah.
You know, Joe Thornton didn't play back then when he was 18, let alone Patrice Bergeron, a second line or a second round pick. He came in and was just better every day. Every single day he was better. He never made a mistake. Like you said, he was so good defensively right off the bat. Didn't know much English at the time. Didn't speak very much. Even being a roommate as an 18-year-old kid, you know, we would just go back and sleep. That's all he wanted to do. He wanted to play hockey and he wanted to sleep.
Fuck, no wonder we didn't fucking make the Hall of Fame, eh?
We forgot about one thing.
Man, I probably shouldn't have gone out those nights in Toronto.
Oh, Razor.
One important thing, huh?
Sleep and play hockey. Why did I know that?
Yeah. So that's lesson number one that I missed out on. However,
you were a good pro.
And Razor, what fuels him? What's his, like, you know, what's his, is it, it's winning, obviously. This is what fuels most of these guys. But what... Do you still see this fire in him? Like, he's still one of the best players in the world today.
Yeah, and it's an understated fire. It's one that doesn't. It's not Mark Messier in your face, steely eyed, all business. It's he almost nices you to death. He lived with Marty Lapointe when he was first down here, so he gained so much from Marty, and Marty was that intense in your face. Like, you were scared to be around Marty some days because he was a monster and he was so competitive and wanted to win. But a lot of that trickled down on Patrice. And you see even now when, he got hit in Nashville by Forsberg a couple weeks ago. And you see the wires cross a little bit on him. And he's not going to go and fight anybody. He's smarter than that. But he, you know, he's a predator out there once he, when he gets hit like that. And he can kill guys because he's so much smarter than everyone. He knows what you're doing before you know. So he's already at the spot. So what makes him so great is his competitiveness, his discipline to being a pro every day, first on the ice, last off. And it's like I said, not an exaggeration with him.
That's the opposite of mine, eh? I was last on, first off. Razor, most where's days, lunch? Let's go, days, buddy.
Most days your skates were half tied up getting out on practice.
Razor, lots of talk out here today, buddy. Lots of talk out here today.
Yeah. Yeah. Do whatever you have, do not pass me the puck. I'd tell you
that's why. What I was thinking about waiting to get on the show. I'm like, waiting for Ove, just like waiting to get a ride to the rink. Hey, I'm late again. Clarky's going to kill me. Clarky and Lou are going to kill me because I'm waiting for Ove to get to the rink.
Listen, Razor, you're right about that. But listen, nowadays, I would have been a great pro. I can't sleep in. I go to bed every night at 10 o'clock. I don't really drink during the week. I eat pretty clean. I'm like, I'm fucking 15 years too late here to the party. Like, if I would have been like this, I would have made fucking 100 bananas, Razor. I'd be living down in Baker's Bay or something.
Oh, boy. There would have been a bunch more backhand sauces kicking around the National League still.
That's true. Razor, I want to talk to you about the Bees this year. And listen, fella, you do a great job on NESN. I love watching you. But let's talk about their start. Like, were you worried at all? Were they fucking around with us? Were they just like, okay, listen, we're a veteran team. It's going to take us a little bit to get going here. Because goaltending wasn't a problem. The two guys played great. What took this team a while to get her going?
I think they had more pieces join the mix this year. They had four or five new free agents that were older guys, not guys that were in the system, just completely blank slates coming in. And for me, yes, I believe in this group. I believe in Brad Marchand. I believe in Patrice Bergeron. Until they're 58, even if they're still, I still think they're going to find a way. So I've
on the Champions Tour, you're like them still.
Yeah. I kept belief in them, but typically they turn it around quicker than they did this season. Typically they come out to a 19-3 start and just kind of cruise the rest of the way. They've struggled. COVID's an issue. They just dealt with more things. I think they weren't able to really get their groove. And then they had the break. Everybody got COVID. They all got to hang out again. And you've seen the last few weeks that they're back to playing the hockey you expect them to.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, obviously when they signed Allmark and what's the other guy, Swayman? Swayman's a guy that's been there for a bit. But what do you think is going to happen with the goaltending situation moving forward? Like, I always thought if they could bring Rask back, why not? He's played pretty well since he's been back, but how do you think that will unfold moving forward? Is it something that's a concern for them?
No, they're excited to have Tukka back. Certainly you get a guy like that. And he's been blown out twice. He's played well twice. I don't expect him to really get dialed in, at least until after this All-Star break. With Swayman, he'll go to the minors, and that'll be okay for him too. He's a college kid, didn't have a pro season really last year. Came up and played great. He's played great here in the NHL, but for him to go play a bunch of games in Providence, play in a couple playoff series, that's not going to be the end of his development. And then Allmark's got a 4-year deal. So he's happy either way at this point. He's not grinding to make a paycheck next year. He knows what he's getting. And I think he's happy to share duties with Tukka, and come playoff time, it's best man plays.
Would you say the goaltending before they brought back Tukka at the start of the year, it wasn't the problem of why they got off to a tough start, right?
No, not at all. Yeah. Not at all. It was inconsistency for everyone. I think the goalies had a couple bad games. They always do. And the goaltending position so dependent on what's going on in front of you anyways. So it wasn't an issue. They all knew that Tukka was coming back. This had been communicated all the way through the summer since Tukka. I mean, I've seen Tukka all summer. He's out in the golf course. He's around. So it wasn't like this came out of nowhere last week where, oh, Tuca's coming back. Everyone knew this was happening. So I don't think it affected them. The goaltending's been good all season, and it's just a matter of the power play and David Pastrnak scoring goals, really what it comes down to.
Speaking of your relationship with Tukka, how does that, you know, go back, take us back to the trade back in the day? Like, is there any, you obviously getting traded for Tukka, who at the time hadn't signed with Toronto. How's your relationship with him? How did that whole thing kind of go down? You know, you're back in Boston now, living there, I'm sure, with your family and stuff. But yeah, what was that like back in the day?
Yeah, it's funny. So one, first and foremost, everybody on Twitter, yes, I did get traded for Tukka. Yes, it's all like, and if that's the worst thing that ever happens to me,
for all you Toronto fans,
I got right here tied for franchise wins in Toronto Razors. A great trade.
Fucking right, it is. Who's your?
I still like to think that I saved Tuca's career a whole lot more than anything else, because if he had stayed in Toronto, who knows.
So, I know that he would have flew back to Finland and played the fucking I know. I want to talk to you. We'll talk about Toronto goaltending. I want to ask about Freddie Anderson, but keep going.
So it's interesting. It wasn't easy, especially when I was still playing and still grinding, and you see Tukka here and successful and winning Stanley Cups. And I'm coming back here. My wife's from here. This is Boston's home. It has been. So that wasn't easy when I was 29, 30, 31. And it's great. Now I take it for what it's worth. It makes my kids think I'm was okay at hockey, because they see this guy still playing, and I got traded for him. So that works. What I'm doing, it still connects me. I saw Tukka before the game. We laugh and we joke. And like I say, he's got kids. Our kids went to the same school at some point. So it's not something we talk about. It's just, we're just two goalies. But certainly the knuckleheads on Twitter that think it's such an insult to call me out for getting traded for Tukka, like I didn't know that or didn't recognize it, is absolutely incredible to this day.
You're like, check the career earnings, fellas. Check the career earnings.
that's what Tukka could say to me, too.
Well, no, not the Tukka. I'm talking about those, what'd you call them, knuckleheads on Twitter?
Well, and now that actually transitions us to Twitter. Fucking Brad Marchand is absolutely killing it on Twitter. And Obes and I, right now, we consistently are like sending each other messages. This guy's just perfect. It's exactly what the game needs. He's chirping other players. He's chirping teams.
Organizations. He's chirping everyone.
It's just perfect. Obviously, in our world, we're all about content and people being personalities. You got to love this stuff. And how does it, even when he pulled the phone out, yeah, the guy's phone going in through the tunnel. It's fucking awesome.
So good.
Do you? What's he like as a guy? Is this something that you thought he would engage in? Like, the only guy I know was doing it was Biz back in the day.
Yeah, it's been great, and it's typical, not necessarily a Bruin thing. You know, you think of guys like Zdeno Chara, and a pretty serious organization, in historically serious group. And it feels like with Pasternak and now Marchand, those guys are really loose and making the game really popular, not only in Boston, but everywhere. So they're embracing the social media. It's great to see. It's fun for all of us. And those guys are great. Brad's same thing. Our kids played on the same hockey team last season, so I got to know him off the ice really well. Just a great person, very respectful. You wouldn't hangs out with all the parents, not putting his head down the rink and walking out. He understands that he has a responsibility to grow the game, to be a good person. And despite everything that's happened on the ice and the line he plays on, because he needs to do that, because he is so competitive and that's what he needs to do to be great. He's the opposite and very genuinely nice person. And I'll go back to my number 37 guy who's brought him along that way. And exactly. I think really showing how everyone in the organization should act and deal with other people and treat other people outside of the game.
Yeah. And the thing that I respect the most about 63 Marchand's game is that the way he still goes the dirty areas and competes and gets the fucking stick in the face. Like, what's he making? 8 bananas? He's making 8 bananas. He's fucking top 5 in the last 10 years in scoring or 5 years in scoring. He doesn't have to play that way, but he continues. That's what fuels him, huh?
Yeah. There isn't anyone as competitive as him in the league.
It's crazy.
You know, you put Sid's right there, right? Sid is the ultimate, right? You think of ultimate competitors, you got Sid. I'm putting Brad right with him or very, very, you know, right behind him if Sid's the best.
Yeah. I would agree with that.
Those two guys compete. They come out with a puck every single time they go into the corner, one way or the other.
I agree with that. And Razor, I want to ask you about a guy. I'm hard on this guy a lot, Taylor Hall. I'm hard on him for a couple reasons, Razor, that have to do with I'll leave that alone. But listen, when it comes to this on-ice stuff.
That's what we're doing?
We're leaving that alone for now. We're going to leave that alone for now, Razor. Even though this is called Missing Curfew, we should probably get into it. But let's just say sometimes the truth hurts. Eh? He said a few things about our experience at Coachella that rubbed me the wrong way. And then I guess I've been hard on him because, you know, he was, what, first overall? Yeah. And all the chances he got. Am I too hard on him? Has he been a good B? Like, last year I ripped him in playoffs. He's having a decent year. He's got, what has he got, 27 for you guys. You watch him every night. Am I too hard on him?
Well, I don't know exactly what you've said or what's exactly, but there's been times where the inconsistency, and he's had that rep through his career, and it certainly was part of the case the first 25 games. When he came over last season, it was night and day. It was lights out. He was right away, him and Krejci hit it off. They were lightning for the last seven games of the season, first round of the playoffs. The Islanders series, that was just a tough matchup for the Bruins. Too big on defense. They leaned on everybody too much. This season, he signs his deal. He loves Boston, the whole thing. But it doesn't start very well. He has that inconsistency to his game. The centerman's in and out. Now, since the break with David Pastrnak, they're pushing the pace. Eric Hall is in the middle. They're a much faster line. Taylor looks very comfortable now. He looks like he's happy to dictate, happy to carry the line, happy to get out on the rush on that left wing. So I think certainly you could probably have been too hard on him in the last 3 weeks is what I would say. He's coming around. He's figuring out how to be a Bruin, figuring out how to lead behind Patrice and just play his game, but do it with a lot of speed.
How is he, before I turn it back to Uppy, how is he? I know you're not in the room and COVID and the stuff, but how is he? Can you tell how he is in the room? Is he a good team guy? Like, that's, I question that too throughout his career. Like, is he a good team guy? I don't know if you can see that because of COVID or whatever, but.
It's hard to see. I've been down a few times when I'm back hanging out in the trainer's room with the guy, the trainers. He comes in, he comes right over, shakes hands, you know, the whole thing. So it doesn't seem like he's being quiet from my point of view. And I haven't talked to anyone about it. Yeah. So but from what I've seen, very personable, very, very comfortable in his skin.
Cool.
News is out. Olympics are coming up. David Krejci is going to play for the Czech Republic team, which is awesome, I think, for hockey. Good for Czech. Looking at their lineup, obviously B's been one of the top teams in the league down the stretch here. Could they make room for a guy like this if he has a great Olympics? Do they miss him? Do you think, like, you just mentioned Taylor Hall and him having such good chemistry last year down the stretch, and that was, Hall was scoring at will. But, you know, a team can maybe grab a guy like this. Would the Bees make room for him to bring him back if he has a good Olympics and wants to come back?
They'd blow out three walls in the garden.
Fucking right, they would.
He's incredible. And becoming more underrated by the day. I think that he's out of the National Hockey League. And so yeah, the answer is yes. I don't know how it works, waiver wire. I don't know how it works, but they would find a way to get his contract in. They would find a way to get him back. And there's been a lot of hope. Everyone's kind of hung on to that hope since he left in the summer. Well, you look at his statement. Oh, he never really retired. He never really fired his paperwork. Maybe he can come back at the end of the season. Maybe he comes back after a year. So there's no question they would love to have him back. If they had, and I don't know if you guys saw the comments about, and it was lost in translation possibly, but David Krejci did an interview back home a couple weeks ago talking about how David Pastrnak got sent down to Taylor Hall's line, and how if that had happened the last few years, that would have been really nice to be able to play with David. He always wanted to play with David, but they never broke up the top perfection line, quote unquote, to let him play with David. And he sounded disappointed in that, maybe they can dangle that carrot and let him play on the second line with Hall, and Hall, Krejci, Pastrnak might do some damage come playoff time.
Big time. And I got to go back to Taylor Hall here. So do you think they sent Pastrnak down to get Halsey going? Is that
what? Yeah.
So Razor, my point is, he's supposed to be that good of a player that he doesn't need someone to come down to his fucking line to get him going. He's Taylor Hall. Like, you should be able to get your second line going.
I agree, but I'll also say David was not producing either.
Okay.
So Pasta went down. Pasta only had seven goals going into the Christmas break, or the whatever you want to call it. He's had 12 since. So they got the both of them going. I don't think they would have dropped David down had he already had 25 goals. But because he was struggling, I think it was a mix to get both of them attention.
Timing, yeah. That's just timing's everything, right? They need to shuffle the deck. I understand that. Razor, I got to ask you about the guy that I've loved since he's been a Bruin, Jake DeBrusk. Every time I hear the media, they're all over this guy in Boston. I don't know. He plays in straight lines. He plays physical. I know he's only got 6 goals, but like, I don't know. He seems like a Boston Bruin to me. Is he kind of getting a rough ride, or is it deserved, or what's his future, you think?
Well, I wouldn't say it's always been deserved, but it's similar. The inconsistency is the issue. And you look at what he was his first year in the league, and this is Cam Neely speaking over the holiday break, and where, you know, that 2018 Jake DeBrusk against the Toronto Maple Leafs in the first round, where he's hitting Kadri over and over and over again. They're going at it, not every shift. He's drilling Riley nonstop, scoring big goals in game 6 and in game 7. That hasn't been the same. So there has been a progression down when it comes to physicality, when it comes to every single shift, the focus and intensity there. And so most of it's body language. Most of it's none of us really know. Most of it's from all of us just watching from the 5th floor and the 9th floor. And you know how easy it is to judge everybody from that perspective.
Yeah.
The other thing is the coaching staff has called him out at times for not working hard enough. And that's as bad as it gets, right? You get the lazy, you get the soft, you get the not working hard. That tells you a little bit more what's going on internally, and also might tell you a little bit about just where Jake is with the personality here. So
totally. Yeah.
That leads to asking for trades. That leads to being on the 9th floor here in Boston. But it's also led to him stepping up in the last month, to be honest. Since asking for a trade, I think his game's gotten more consistent. To your point, he's been on straight lines. He's been skating on a more consistent basis. And he's on that third line where he has a little less pressure to produce that offensive goal. And he has a better matchup there with Charlie Coyle. So he's done a very nice job since asking for a trade, or since it coming out. He asked for a trade in the summer, obviously. Yeah. But since it coming out publicly, when he feel like it's an awkward situation, he's done a good job being a pro and managing that.
Yeah, writing's on the wall.
I'm gonna ask you about a guy where I think DeBrusk is gonna be going the other way for this guy if it does happen. But first, on the 9th floor, good popcorn up there, good dogs, and fuck, the game looks easy up there, Razor, doesn't it? The game looks easy up there. Every time it was a scratch,
it's
I'm so easy. Fuck, I can make that play. Like, I had 3 seconds to make that play.
Especially if you're a healthy scratch, you're like, Jesus, really?
That's what it was. It was healthies. Razor, Jacob Chychrun, I don't think Phoenix should move him. We had Tyson Nash on my show with Cooley a couple weeks ago. He thinks the management company of Phoenix is solid. They're going to put the rink in a good place. That's neither here nor there. There's rumors to Boston. I think DeBrusk would be a guy that would be going back to the desert. Do you think Boston goes all in for Chychrun? Do you love this? Or how do you like their back end so far?
No. They need to add something. They certainly need to add something. You see it when they play the Carolinas of the league, just the big, strong, fast forwards. The Bruins are really good at moving the puck. Guys like Grizzlick, Riley, the good first pass guys. But they need to get a little heavier back there. And whether that's, you know, Victor Hedman heavy, top number one horse, or it's a 5th or 6th guy that you can rely on, or like a Derek Forbert, to pair him, those two guys together, kill penalties, have him Carlo out there on the ice killing defensive zone time as well. So, do they sell the farm for a Chychrun? It feels like to me that somebody else is going to offer them more. It feels like Boston won't go all in as much as someone else might at this point, but I got to imagine they're kicking tires on it. And when you have pieces like Jake DeBrusk, and you might be able to slide something through.
Maybe like a Shabbat from Montreal. I know Montreal and Boston don't make like a trades, but that might be a nice little back end. A lot of people are going to be after that guy Shabbat. In a couple months.
Shabbat. Yeah. But that's exactly it. That's the guy the Bruins need, where you don't have to pay as much. The issue is, of course, Montreal, Boston don't always dance too well in trade time.
That's true.
No one wants to lose that one, that's for sure.
Razor, last thing on the bees here. You know, me and Uppy were hard on Canada with no fans, but the Garden's been rocking lately. Every time I watch a game, they've been winning. How fucking good is that Dirty Water song after they win the game, eh? It gets me, I'm like, on the couch, I'm like, fuck, maybe I will go tonight. What time is it? Maybe I will go. How great is that after you win a game as a player, as working for the squad? It's a great tune.
It is a great tune. You certainly feel like you need to go find an Irish bar and crush
you can find a few there.
Yeah, oh yeah, it's on. You walk, trip off the sidewalk, you fall into an Irish bar around here. It's very Bostonian, and like you guys know, Boston's so obsessed with themselves, I guess you could say. They Boston people are very proud of their accent and their Dirty Water song, so they love it even more because they feel like it's their own.
And you know what? Obviously, we lost our boy Hazy this summer, right? And we went into for his funeral. And you hear about Boston, right? And you see, you remember the marathon of people rallying behind it. And like the way that city in Dorchester rallied around Jimmy Dying and the cops, you know, the intersections. And it felt like you felt how strong Boston has that feel when something good or bad happens to their city.
It's very provincial and it's an extremely small, big city. You're 1 degree away from everybody here, especially in the hockey world, whether it's the Hayes family, the Yandel family, the Fitzgerald family, whoever it is, yeah. You know, you pass one of them in the rink every day. I see one of those guys. I see somebody from Dorchester or Milton or Southie in a hockey rink every single day that's connected to guys like Jimmy or the end, whoever it is. Yeah. And that's what drives that community feel here. There really is a community feel despite the size of Boston, because everybody knows each other. And if you need to know something about someone, or if you need to get in touch with someone, it's literally one text to somebody who gets that person. So it's really community. And yeah, I mean, Jimmy's situation, that it proves it more than anything else.
Yeah, yeah. It blew us away. So Razor, I love you, buddy. We got to get you back on. I got way more stuff here for you.
But I need to hear it was like fucking you two playing together. I need an O'Brien story here before he leaves or something.
That could be a whole other podcast.
I only had a cup of coffee with Obes in Florida, just a cup.
And yeah, thank God. It was a nice cup.
It was a good cup of war. Yeah, it was a nice.
It's a nice cup.
Yeah, my cup was full. This is the bet. This is what I was thinking about, because I knew we'd get to one. And this, I think, kind of sums up where I was, where we were there. So I just had my son. I'm married. I'm not on the same, you know, schedule as Obi at that point now. But love Obi more than anything. Hey, Obes. I'm coming out. I signed with Vancouver, but I'm not getting a place right away, the whole thing. I'm not staying in a hotel either, because I'm like a 9-year NHL vet. I'm not staying in the hotel doing NHL training camp. So, Obes, can I stay with? Oh, yeah, of course. Absolutely.
Come on in, Razor. Come on in.
It's a bit of a longer story. So the best is the first day. And I'm fighting with Corey Schneider. So like, I can't, like, I'm not chasing. Like, I got to play well. Land in Vancouver, haven't slept for 2 weeks. I just had a newborn son. Can't wait to get to Van. Drop my bags, get to Obes on a Saturday night at like 8 o'clock. I fly in, put my stuff down. I'm sitting on the couch, and Obes is getting antsy, right? Like, he's getting a little antsy, but he doesn't want to be rude because I just got there. And then finally he's like, hey, Race, you mind if I go out for a little while? Yeah, like, I just gotta go meet a couple people. Like, do you mind if I... Obes, absolutely, like, of course, get out of here. So I go to bed at probably 3:30 in the morning. There's a party in the kitchen. I'm like, all right, here it's gonna be a fun month.
Yeah. I mean I wasn't worried about you making the squad. I guess you were. I was like, Razor, you got this. You can't be out of your pocket. We got this, bud. And then Razor obviously made the team, but then he lived in Cole Harbour with me, and what I remember is we would drive to practice together and stuff like that to the airport. And a lot of times I would drive to the airport and Razor would drive home. And when we land, I go, Razor, here's the keys, buddy.
Well, and mostly, I would also say probably 50 to 60% of the time, halfway home was me by myself after me dropping you off somewhere. I'd get the rig back to Cole Harbor, and then I'd pick you up the next morning for practice.
Oh, man. Razor was there when I slept in for practice, too. Razor.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When the hunt went on the radio station.
I never asked you, how was that from your perspective when you're like, where the fuck is this guy? Yeah.
Horrible.
I never asked you that.
No, it was horrible. I was thinking of that last night when I knew we were talking, because that was the worst. I must have called you 500 times.
Yeah.
And because I had already been there at the rink, because we weren't riding together that day for whatever reason. And had I been there, I would have been able to run over, and I don't know if I would have been able to wake you up.
I didn't plug the old phone charger in, eh? Like, I fucking came in, stumbled around. It didn't help. I hit every bar in Vancouver that day, every single fucking one, Razor. Then I hit the roller on the way home. I'm like, fuck it, I'll go in for one. Go to plug it in, doesn't plug in, wake up, phone charges. I'm like, oh, fuck, here we go. Get to the barn. I don't know if you remember. I tried to scramble to get my gear on.
Yeah, and then I told you don't bother.
And Bernie's like, you're not going out there. I'm like, fuck that. I'm going to go out there. I'm ready. Let's go. I can snap this around. Go ride the bike. Ride the bike. You remember how AV would do his press conferences? Then remember TC Carling? TC comes in. I go, what did AV say about me there? He's like, well, they asked about 10 times where Shane O'Brien was. And he said 10 times, I'm not going to talk about Shane O'Brien. I'm like, it's probably not perfect. He's like, no, you're in one here, bud. I'm like,
That's the worst. But that's why we got the name of our podcast here, Razors. Fucking Missin' Curfew.
I think I didn't even miss curfew. I think I got home that night about midnight, but I was so squashed.
Missin' practice. We could have called it Missin' practice.
It would have been crispy rice. That would have been my best practice of my career. I would have been like so focused. I would have been like,
you would have been dialed in.
I'm not missing the pass.
Guilty hockey. We've all been there.
Kess or Burr would have chipped it in your corner every single time, those two.
And remember Kess when I popped off? I think it was in the media or something that year. He came in, he played that song, It's Too Late to Apologize. I got in trouble. He's like, it's too late. I'm like, fuck you, Kessler. So
I saw Kess and Juice last night at dinner.
No way.
Yeah, I told him we had you coming on today, and they said to say hi. Yeah, boys are doing good.
We had a good group of guys in Vancouver. Awesome. Yeah, we had a good group of guys. I mean, when you play against those guys, Razor, you truly hate them. Even after I played in Vancouver, we played Nashville against Vancouver in the playoffs, and I tried to fight Bjaxka. I wanted to kill Kessler and Burr, but when they're on your team.
This is funny. Kess last night, he goes, you know what I still remember? And he was kind of, he had the honest juice going, you know, he had a couple of bottles.
Yeah, he gets honest when he gets
The one time Philly was going to trade, like they were going to offer me like an offer sheet, and you came out in the media and said, I would not offer this guy nothing to get on this team. No chance. And I came out in the media and said it. I'm like, Kess, you know what it's like when you're playing? Like now these guys are soft. Like they don't say shit to really anyone other than like the Marchands right now and stuff. But I'm like, I fucking hated you. You were an American. I was a Canadian. We battled in fucking, you know, that. Yeah. And then we come in the league and you're fucking playing the way you do. And I play the way I do. I didn't want you on the fucking Philadelphia Flyers, although you probably would have helped our team big time. We could have won, but
he was sick back then.
Sick, you know. So and I said, call it like you know, it's me looking up to you actually to chirp you like that. It's kind of like I'm not going to tell you to fucking.
Remember you come to the rink and Cass would be like. I'm like, what do you have to be fucking depressed about today? You're making fucking 5 bananas. You're on pace for 40. So what? Your wife's bugging you? Like, come on, fella. Like, I haven't played in a week here. Like, come on.
Yeah, you're not fooling anybody, Cass. Like, you don't have to be tough in this room.
Yeah,
like,
totally.
We don't care, fella. We know you're tough. Smile here. We're playing
the rest of the league.
We're playing the National League. Razor, remember how I have to weigh in every day? I'd go in the steamer in there, and I'd just be hung cheese in the steamer. Come out, get on the scale. Roger Takahashi, I'm like, 234. I'm like, mark down 231, Raj. Okay, go out there, practice. I'm like, does AV think this is helping me or
fucking
what?
I don't know Raj. What's going he on. Was still there when I went up for camp on Raj.
The best. I would love being in that weight room for the way off.
The way off? It was a way off. We should have sold Razor, we should have been partners. We should have sold pay-per-view tickets for that fucking
What about
thing.
Welly? How about Wellwood? How is he?
Guys.
Yeah. How about the barrel he had on him? He had a good little beer-drinking barrel on him, didn't he?
Did he ever? This changed Welly's trajectory in Vancouver. And Razor was the first year. You weren't there yet. We go out and get absolutely fucking pinned. And you know, remember the hot tub, cold tub is in Vancouver, kind of by the showers there?
Way in the back.
Yeah. So Mitchie Babe comes in and goes, what the fuck did you do to your boy Welly? I'm like, I wasn't with Welly. I was not with Welly last night. He's like, fuck off. I'll go check the hot tub. And there he is, buck naked, 1 foot in, cock hanging out. I go give him a tap. I'm like, Willie, what are you doing? He's like, oh, is there any meetings? I'm like, no meetings. He's like, wake me up 5 minutes before practice. Slept the entire time without snapping around. But after that, he kind of, I think, obviously people found out and they're like, hey.
Welly,
I love that kid.
And our year Razor, my second year, your first year in Vancouver, Welly was so good for us, especially in playoffs. Again, remember how good he was?
He won every faceoff. He did that little kick faceoff thing.
He kicked the guy's stick.
Draw, yeah, win it right back with his little stick.
Oh, you know, hey, Razor, you know what Pitter cannot let go to this day? Remember we won game one, we smoked them like 6-1, and then we were up like 2-0 or 2-0.
We were up 3-0 in the first.
Yeah. But then the third, we were up a goal late or something, right? Yeah. My dad's like still this day. He's like, you guys win that game, you win the series. I'm like, Pitter, it's time to let her go.
It's the Hawks.
Yeah, No. I'm the same way as Pitter. We win the cup that year.
If we get by them, I think we win it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Fuck. Oh, Mitchie Babe was hurt. That killed us.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, Mitchie was hurt. That did kill us, right? Who'd we pick up? We picked up Andrew Alberts. And was Andrew Alberts on the team?
Big Al.
Yeah, so we didn't have Mitchie. Mitchie was our guy. He had Conkers. And speaking of Mitchie, remember he come in the rink and he's like, I hadn't been outside in fucking 2 months, right, Razor? I'm like, fella, I don't know much about concussions, but if I sat in my house for a month and then came out, I don't think I'd be firing all cylinders either here. Like, I think we got to get you back in the room here. Get you blood. Hey, let's get the blood flowing. You want to play some cards or what? You want to talk?
Get in the shower with the boys? Come on.
Want to have a soak or what? Come on. Oh, Razor, I love you, buddy. We could do this forever. We'll have you back on, man. Do you got a podcast going now in Boston or something?
I do, What is it? I better plug that.
Yeah, give it a plug, baby. Give it a plug.
Yeah. Morning Brew with Jaffe and Razor. So Jaffe and I are doing, we do like 20 minutes after twice a week, just Bruins, what they're doing, the games here in Boston. Not a lot of talk radio is Bruins centric. It's all Patriots and Red Sox. So we're trying to hit that. So any Bruins fans out there listening, want to check it out. Morning Brew with Jaffe and Razor.
Sweet. Bruins fans are everywhere, by the way. I do a call-in show with NHL Sirius XM and it'll be like guy from Fort Worth. We're like, think about the Stars. He's like, fucking Bruins, man. I'm like, what the fuck? All right, fella. Go Bees. Razor, thank you, man. I love you. I miss you. Let's try to play some golf eventually. How do you keep that swing going in the wintertime there? How do you got an indoor thing? Or what do you do?
I'll get in a couple of the bays. It's not the same as getting that fresh air, but you know, the club has the simulator. So you get in there and have a few cocktails and make it an afternoon.
There you go.
But that's awesome. It's not the same. So we'll definitely, I got to get out west at some point here. Yeah. Live your lives.
Thank you, Razor. Miss you, buddy. You. Thank you.
Up there's all
Draft wild card Kings, weekend, baby. DraftKings app. We had her humming. Bengals humming. Bucks humming. And then the Cowboys.
The Cowboys and the Eagles laid an egg on us. They sure did. But our boy Flowers was out there witnessing it all.
So he took it on the chin.
He definitely did. The NFL playoffs are heating up, and so is your shot, big fella, at winning huge cash prizes with DraftKings, the official daily fantasy partner of the NFL. This week, new customers can play free for millions with their first deposit. Don't sit on the sidelines. Get in the game.
You got to get in the game, boys. Playing daily fantasy football is simple. Just pick your lineup of NFL stars while staying under the salary cap and score enough points to bring home cash. And with a free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes, you'll feel the NFL action like never before. DraftKings is safe, secure, reliable, and best of all, you can just deposit, and withdraw your cash whenever you want, up dog.
Damn, is that nice.
That was a hard word. Deposit, baby. Hey,
download the DraftKings app now and use promo code
Curfew Kings
to play free for millions. That's right. Promo code Curfew Kings to get a free shot at millions in total prizes with your first deposit. Do not miss out. Download the DraftKings app and play the daily official fantasy partner of the NFL. Minimum $5 deposit required. Eligible restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com for details.
DraftKings is everywhere, up dog. Updog, Razor, eh? You first time you guys have met.
Yeah, he's got a big smile on the front of the guy's face.
He would have came over to you every morning and been like, what's up, Ups?
Tell me
something.
A little coffee and Bailey's.
Yeah, tell me, Uppy, what'd you do last night? Uppy,
I would have told him.
And he wanted to hear it just because he was married. His wife's unbelievable and that. But he's a team guy. He was great for me in Vancouver for a lot of reasons. We drove the rink together. You know, I could bounce ideas off him. If things weren't going well, talk to him. So great laugh, great guy. And he was a great goalie.
Good
career.
Yeah.
We're going to have him back on because there's so much more we could have talked about with him. But like in Toronto, how the media, having to handle the media every day. Yeah, like, he tied the franchise record.
Do you know who that's with, maybe?
Eddie Belfour.
It's with Eddie Belfour? What about Felix?
The cat. Anyways, I love Razor. We got to play golf with him. He's got a nice smoothie Dougie swing.
I'd love to.
Yeah. We got to get him
a full golfing match against some of our best guests.
Yeah.
Right? I think the fans want to see that.
My game's getting good. I'm ready.
Let's fucking go.
I'm ready. So thank you, Razor. Up Dog, always a pleasure. We got All-Star Week next week. We're going to talk some All-Star stuff.
Yeah, big week.
Thank you to our listeners
yep.
in Australia and Great Britain, I guess, coming in.
Oh, down under.
Down under.
Fuck,
whenever COVID is done there, we should go down there for a little trip. That
Aussie.
Man, me and Loops went there. I didn't want to leave.
Yeah.
I didn't want, Loops made me leave. I'm still mad about it.
I might have to run that one by the old lady. Eh?
Yeah, bring her.
Yeah.
Bring her. We'll do a little business, plastic pleasure, and Izzy can get down there and do the fucking,
see a kangaroo. Yeah.
I never saw a kangaroo, though. I was on the wrong side. You got to go on the Melbourne side.
Heads up, they'll kick you in the nuts. You ever see those? Those things are vicious, man.
Vicious. When they get all muscular like that? Yeah, totally. Great Britain, thank you. London, wide open. Let's go to London. No mask, fucking drink. Let's go.
Oh, I did some damage.
I'm coming over there. Yeah. That's an understatement there.
Yeah, sure. It's a slugger. I got the international slugger.
You may not be welcome back in London. You might have to check the fucking... There may be a picture of you on the fucking... Right when you land at... What is it, Heathrow?
That is Heathrow,
it's just like fucking Upshaw. Too much damage done. I met you guys halfway through that trip. You motherfuckers too. And I'm like, is there a bed for me? Yeah, don't worry, there's a bed.
Pull out.
I get over there, couch. I'm like, fuck.
I know.
Anyways, it was fun. Paris, London, it was great. So thank you to them. Maxi, what'd you say? Our platforms?
Yeah, no.
Check us out. Chirp us. Yeah.
Leave us some reviews. Watch us on our YouTube. You see our handsome faces. Silly ass fucking remarks. And so our YouTube channel, leave a review. Chirp us. Engage. We always love when the fans engage, right,
yeah,
Oaks?
It's awesome, yeah.
Spotify, Apple Music. Or no, Apple Podcasts.
Apple Podcasts.
Do you use Apple Music or Spotify?
Which one sponsors us?
Neither.
I use Spotify then. Come on, Spotify. Give us Rogan's deal. We'll take Rogan's deal. That's not asking too much, right? What's he making, 60 bananas?
Let's go hang out with Joe. Let's go
to Austin. I would love to hang out with Joe Rogan. Love to.
Yeah.
Uppy, great show. Next week, we're in the studio. Then we're fucking heading to Vegas, baby. And we will get into that next week.
Work Maxie
week. Binger, thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Up Dog, I was missing Curfew.